allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Do a roll call. Basting.
Here.
Bush.
Here.
Chambers.
Here.
Dunn.
Here.
Dunlop.
Here.
Lindsey.
Here.
Stepas.
Here.
All present. Recognitions. We have the Boys State Track starting us off today. I see Coach Paul Skill is here. Would you like to give us a little bit of highlights of the track? And maybe if the guys could come up and the gals, just guys.
Two men here. We had three young men.
Come on up over here, Kevin and Josh.
So a couple weeks ago already, it seems like a longer, it seemed not longer with me, it seemed like just a couple days ago, but what past the last 2 weeks. If you're familiar with track and field, 18 events, and we had on championship Saturday, we had the first event of the meet, which is always the 4x8, and we had the very last event of the meet, which is the 4x4. So we started running at 10:30, and then we ran again at about 5:30, I think it was, Josh, right, Kevin? So we had the first event, which was a group of Dodgers there, Garrett, Isaac, Henry, and Peyton. And then this crew, again, the one person on both teams was Isaac Grudo on the right. Set the story straight, basically we were seated fourth going in, and that's exactly where we finished. The good news was that they set a school record in finishing fourth, so it was kind of a big moment that way. And I know, Josh, for sure that was your best split of your career, a 50.3 in open four, in the 400. Kevin, I think you ran maybe one better, but you were smoking too at like a 50.7, I believe.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So both these guys did a wonderful job. So two Minnow Point kids and two Dodgeville kids on that team. So good news for Kevin is he's back again. Bad news is Josh is going to move on as a senior, heading up Rival University to play football next fall. So we appreciate the work that they've done and look forward to Kevin down the road and wish Josh the best as he moves. So
extend our gratitude and appreciation to the Dodgeville coaches as well. It's a great partnership and a co-op, and we're glad that you guys did so well. And congratulations on a personal record and a placement. So. Let's join us. I was going to wait until we got a little closer
to that spring or summer one.
Yeah, but we could do WASB. I mean, we're still waiting for somebody on that as well. Coming events, they're not showing anything. I will have to look at that date. I'm sorry that I don't have it at my fingertips. I know we tabled it from May to June, and or that early meeting in May to June.
So what's it called?
July 13th?
CISA 3 delegate.
You have from June of 18 to June of 17?
That's
search range, if that makes a difference.
Thank you.
Annual delegate convention?
Yes.
Looks like July 28th.
This isn't helping either, but July 28th?
That's what I have.
I'm going to go with that. I'll double check that date.
What happens if we have nobody that can go?
We lose our ability to have input, voice, and vote as a representative of CISA 3. July 28th, correct?
You said July.
That's what you have.
Yeah.
What's on my look after?
Well, that's why, maybe that's why I'm asking, is it June?
I said, oh, I'm sorry, this is 2016.
Yeah, that's what I thought. I thought Joy.
I think you have it in that.
The Summer Institute Leadership, is that what we're talking about for WASB?
No, this is CSA.
Three, and I had the, I got the wrong year.
You got the wrong year?
Yeah.
What year?
I was in 2016.
That was a good year.
Thursday, July 26th. What I got.
There we go. I have it as well. Thursday, July 26th, 6 to 8:30 PM. That's at Fenimore at CISA 3. We will get you registered if we have a representative from the board that is planning to attend.
Is there a registration deadline before the July meeting?
There is not. We use a tool called My Quick Registration where we can log you in and register you for the event.
All right. Should we just bring it back to the July meeting?
We can do that.
We have to 7:24. Okay, board communications received. Anybody have anything?
Well, I spoke a little bit about before, but we're going to. Concerns I heard at graduation mostly were about the camera, and Luke said that that could be changed. People aren't seeing the screen, they aren't seeing everyone, and they're not hearing very well, or they can't hear us very well, so.
I also had that one written down, so I guess by next meeting, can we have that moved?
You want something installed, audio visual enhancement?
Well, I guess I don't have a problem with this, but I think it should be on that end looking this way, because that's what my
position changed.
Yeah.
We tried that, and that didn't go well, so.
Well, then how are we supposed to let people see what's on the screen, Joelle?
I'm just saying that we've done that already, so we can look at another option, but it may be cost, there may be a cost to that.
So clarifying, Kelly, were you describing a different camera system or just relocating?
Just relocating that.
Okay.
And if we have to move.
I'd be happy to move.
And then people, and if it has to be centered so everyone are up so they can even look down, you know, then people will just have to sit on either side of the camera.
Sure.
But it just seemed, it was such a thing that I was.
I only had a couple, but yeah, it's not the first time.
I was overwhelmed by the number of comments.
We will try that for next meeting.
Go around here.
We had it back here, and people said that they couldn't hear. I think it was right here, and people said they couldn't hear the board speak. Then, so they could see the screen but not hear the board.
Can we just try it there?
We also there are devices where you could put a center microphone.
There's a shotgun mic on the camera.
Or like I think Mr. Carey, who's not here this summer, but you could ask him. He's got what's called some sort of blue microphone that would sit in the middle of the table, but I'm not sure how it hooks up to the feed of that. So.
We're looking at options to bring something back to the board.
Okay.
If you need someone to experiment, I can come and sit and talk.
Okay. Citizens communication. Do we have anybody in the audience
who would like
to speak? Jenny?
Hi, my name is Jenny Pete. I'm a parent here at the district. My daughter Hayden is going to be in kindergarten next year. I have another daughter who will be in preschool in 2019. I'm just here with a recommendation on the school safety issue. I want you guys to know that I highly recommend the Blue U Defense. They're a training and behavioral awareness company. I personally sat through a training of theirs. For my job, and at banks we do safety training all the time, and usually it's kind of this news vest and you feel like you're doing training just to do training, and I'm sure we've all sat through trainings like that. It was a 2-hour meeting at night, and it was the best training I had ever been to. It was practical, it was engaging, it was effective. I actually left there feeling refreshed, feeling pumped, went home and had a discussion with my five-year-old about what she should do if there's somebody in her school with a gun. And it wasn't scary and it wasn't a big conversation, but I want her to feel safe, and in a big part of her feeling safe is I want her to feel prepared and I want her to feel empowered. And I really feel like Blue University did a great job in instilling that in us as bank employees, which led to a lot of discussions at home. I have vetted them. They will come do site assessments and in-person training. I know they would be more than willing to let somebody from the board or administration come in and sit in on one of their trainings when they're in Wisconsin. Our training that we had was just on May 10th, and they were just in Wisconsin again last week doing a training for Johnson Controls. So I think it's something if we reach out, it appears that they get here often enough to hopefully be included to maybe let somebody here in this room see how they feel about the training. The cost for the training, they charge $4,500 per site. So we would have two sites and $3,000 for the training. However, they did let me know that if they can do that on a week when they were in Wisconsin and do the training and the site evals the same day, they would do it for $5,000. My husband and I also are willing to chip in a couple hundred dollars to bring that below the $5,000 threshold if that helps anything out or makes that less of an issue. So I just wanted to say my piece and how important I think it is I think it's great that we are a leader in academics and a leader in education, and I would really like Mentor Point to be a leader in school safety. And like I said, the biggest thing I feel is having our teachers be empowered and aware and helping our students feel empowered, which is part of them feeling safe and being safe. So thank you.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Anybody else?
I just signed up at the last minute, sorry. John Murray, 411 South Milo Street. First thing, I believe there was a car accident. Is that not true? No, in the last week of the school? From what I heard?
Not that I'm aware of.
Sorry.
There was a bus, yes, that that had an issue on Front Street where it the buses had swung, the tail end did touch a car.
Yeah. The other issue is that a lot of times they roll right through that stop sign on Front Street and pull up to let kids off in the morning. And it's pretty scary if kids are coming up in front of our house. And I've seen kids have to hit the brakes really hard on their bikes and when they're running or walking, because I've noticed about 30% of those buses go through that stop sign on Front Street to pull up and let them off. Mm-hmm. Okay. And I also observe the same thing when the buses are leaving. And I've seen almost accidents where people are trying to pull into the parking lot and those buses are rolling through that stop sign. I've seen cars have to triple stop because they roll right through that stop sign on Front Street as they're pulling up. So I don't know what the legality is, but I hate to have a kid get hit or a kid standing on the corner. The bus hit a car and pushed it in. Those kids standing by the crosswalk there waiting to go somewhere. The other thing is, when is the community at large going to be able to see the rest of the survey and all the comments on the survey? So if the comments are too large, you can simply scan them and put them in the PDF and attach it to the survey. So the community at large can see the rest of the survey results and all the comments. That would be appreciated for transparency.
Was this based on the planning committee? Is that what you
mean? Right.
Okay.
Sorry, I didn't clarify that. Thanks.
Thanks, John.
Is there a restricted speed on that street during school hours? Is there a sign?
I think it is marked 15 during school hours.
All right.
And no parking on both sides.
On Front Street.
Right.
Yeah. Anybody else?
Can I add something to what I was saying before? I'm sorry. I got distracted. Part of the other reason that I kind of got caught up in not looking at my notes is I feel that the school needs to have a Blue University or group like that come in before we go spending money on bulletproof film, on a new entrance to the high school. I guess I feel it's a fiscally responsible thing to do, is if we are gonna vet one of these companies to come in here and do this, before we go spending the money and doing those things, let's maybe see what an outsider expert has to say about that before we go and do those things. Thank you.
Thank you. Just responding quickly, John, the survey is fully loaded into the board book of today's packet, less the comments. The comments are available in the district office, so anybody who would like to come in and go through the comments are welcome to.
So you just have to, anybody that wants to look at it has to do the extra effort versus...
Correct.
...our form.
Yep.
Why is it different than other surveys in the past?
We don't typically post comments, so that would be pretty standard with how we help other surveys.
There might be some helpful comments that would steer the final design plan.
The board has received the comments, so they have all of those, and they are available for public review if you'd like to come to the office. I'd be more than happy to provide them for you.
Was there a lot of comments?
Yes.
So it would be too hard to put that in a PDF on the webpage, or?
We just don't normally post comments on surveys. It's not been a general standard practice that we've incurred.
I have a question. Luke, you're on Middleton's planning committee for their new elementary?
Was,
okay. Yeah. Did they publish them?
They did not publish comments to my understanding.
Okay. I mean, if we know what other schools are doing, then I think that explanation could be supported. Or yeah. Not supported. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Christy's here. FEH works with multiple schools, does surveys with many of them. When we had a discussion, that was not common practice, but you can speak to whether you do or don't post comments to other school districts' surveys.
Maybe we don't. Sometimes there's identifying information in the comments, so we like to not necessarily post that online. It would be at your discretion ultimately, but we could go through the comments and potentially edit them, just in case there's something in there that we wouldn't want somebody to read, but then they wouldn't be a full view of the comments.
The planning committee, I see some of the members are here too, also received a full set of comments. So those that were closely working with the project have received the full vetting of the survey, and it is available for public review and inspection.
Okay. Items for action. Secure entrance at the middle high school. Elementary, secondary.
I'll defer this over to the Finance Committee and the Operations Committee to take a lead on this item.
Do we have what they were proposing to do on the screen at all?
On the screen?
Everybody kind of already saw it, I guess. The board was interested anyway. So
you want the actual design? Is that what you're asking for?
If you guys want to see it, you guys are yourself.
Well, I was at the meeting, but
yeah, you're right.
Yeah. I think it's reasonable for the other board members.
Well, when we did walk through that day, there was a couple things on there that we noticed that didn't necessarily have to be changed, or not changed, but added back in, like the detention rooms. So we figured that might save us financially. But then everything else, I kind of forget. It was a couple weeks ago, or you were there.
So the original plan that I saw was by Nexus, and then this was, then FEH came?
Correct.
And there was some discussion during that meeting that morning about a site assessment. And through that discussion, you put out to us what our insurance company has recommended. Mm-hmm.
So the EMC insurance company, which is our insurance carrier, did a security assessment. And they recognize that a secured entrance at the high school and middle school is something that is needed. The safety committee, which Aaron Dunn and Nate Chambers are members of, met with Matt Renwick on two consecutive years to review priorities as well, and the secure entrance has been a priority in both of those reports.
Okay.
I think that having an expert, like Jenny said, because I also called that company and spoke with them, and I think I sent a note out to everyone. They don't normally do schools, but they want to do schools, and this was their explanation. Schools are doing what everyone else is doing. They are trying to figure out what to do, and so they're taking information from other people and using that instead of having an expert who comes in and does it. So I did ask one of the safety committee members to vet them, and it was just a look on their website, didn't call them. The guy was more than happy to talk to me. I was excited about that after I spoke with Jenny. It's nice to have someone who's seen them, and I think that we're putting the, although I understand this needs to be in place to get the money, but I also think that without having Blue U Defense assessing the situation before any plans get examined is putting the cart before the horse. And we do that a lot around here, and it doesn't make sense to me.
So help me understand how a new site assessment would be different than the security assessment performed on April 4th, 2017.
These are experts in safety, okay. Not insurance experts.
Okay. So isn't this an insurance company that would cover us if we're sued because of a safety vulnerability that's violated?
What I'm concerned about is preparedness for an active shooter.
Right.
So, in order to put safety in place, I think preparedness for that would be beneficial before we start doing that, because when he, if that person comes in and he examines or tells us how a shooter works or how we're going to do this, putting bulletproof film in there, maybe securing an entrance differently, but this is an expert in preparedness for an active shooter as defense.
Okay.
And that, and I think
I don't disagree with what you're saying.
I think that's really important.
I totally agree. What I'd like to see is an example of a site assessment done by Blue U of a school, and see how much more comprehensive it is than this one we received just last year, and see if it, you know, see if it looks like they go into way more detail than.
May I speak to Jenny?
Yeah.
He had a preliminary school one. Done,
they've done some private schools and they've done some colleges, and I'm sure if I emailed Joe, he would be more than happy to get that to us, and I'm sure I could have it by the end of the week, and I could get that to whoever, I can get that to Luke to get out to the board or whoever. I'm sure he would be very responsive in that.
Yeah, that'd be great. And do you know if this security assessment is available for concerned parents to review to
Absolutely.
See if it would be...
Yeah, we would again
deem satisfactory.
We wouldn't post that on our website because it does display our vulnerabilities.
Right.
But it would be available for anybody to come in and review that and see what the assessment contains.
Okay.
The EMC has different departments. We have had their air quality team come in and try to assess what some of the issues were related to an evacuation last year. We've also had a safety assessment done in our building, which looks at more of code compliance and American Disabilities Act needs. So they have different divisions that they deploy that will try to get to the bottom of what your major issues and concerns are, so that as an insurance carrier, you're as protected as possible. So we have used that security assessment in result of some of the safety concerns that were coming up a year ago to help drive us in some of the things we should be doing at the elementary, middle, high school, and district-wide. A lot of those that were no cost or low cost have been implemented. Some of those have some challenges associated with them. This particular entrance is going to be over $100,000 to repurpose that whole office area to allow traffic to route through. It's the lesser of the two estimates that we received. The first working proposal was from Nexus Solutions, the second from FEH. And with the timeliness of the grant, being able to fund possibly 50 cents on the dollar, that's why it's before the board in short order. It's not built into the budget for next year.
And I think I'm probably talking two different areas. We're talking preparedness and security, but I think they also go hand in hand. And I think without knowing how we prepare, that the security issue may be different. Does that make sense?
Yes. A site assessment is different than training staff for
yes.
an active shooter incident.
Right. And but part of that preparedness, that person would also know entrances and exits and how we should manage those.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah. So there was an active shooter drill performed on both sites this year, is that right?
Yeah, correct.
Okay.
And
so how did that, who administered that and how did that go, and was it deemed inadequate by the administration or by the staff who participated in the drill or parents who
I had
noticed it? Or
Chief Wire, an officer Ottaway in my building.
Uh-huh.
Kelly was actually in the building.
I was in the building.
As well.
Uh-huh.
I guess
my concern is that after speaking with him, and there was also an article that I just read, is that I'm not sure we are the experts on that we're taking information and doing that as experts. I'm not sure county, local county or state are also experts in that. I think that this is so new. Recently, I just read an article that after the Austin shooting, they had an ex-FBI person come in and do that drill, you know, get them prepared, and they didn't use it. You know, they didn't follow through with it. So I think preparedness and who we get to prepare is really important. And we had an opportunity, it went out to the board, or it went to Luke, that they were at Johnson Controls. They do big corporations.
Right, so just to be clear, there was an active shooter training drill happening on this campus this year, and you were part of it,
yeah.
and you thought it was inadequate, and we need more training to be
prepared. No, that's not what I'm saying.
Okay,
I think we need to be better prepared by the right person, or the right company, or the right people who actually know about it.
Okay.
I do not think that local, county, and state have a universal voice that, okay, so now we're getting money for all this. The
okay.
security?
Yeah.
Okay. Everybody's gonna be different. So I don't think anything's gonna be standardized. So let's start with a good standardized preparedness plan and then do our security from that. I think that's a smart way to do it. And the parents that I spoke to when I said it's less than $5,000 and we don't need to have, you know, board approval, they were like, what are you waiting for? I mean, I had a meeting here and a committee meeting, we weren't on that one, we had a space planning committee, and I had a parent come in here and ask why we were concerned about spending $13,000 on the elementary school.
Mm-hmm.
Well, number one, do we know that we did that correctly? And so why are we having an issue with something less than $5,000 or questioning it when we would be better prepared and better spend our money? Because I think that what we did at the grade school, although it was necessary, we backtrack now and do our space planning committee, and that may all change. So within a 2 years' time, you know what I mean? It's like we're just handing out the money without having system or, you know, a thing in place, an organizational, structural thing in place to spend our money wisely. I think we may be reacting on this, and it's okay to react, but I also think that preparedness defense expert is necessary.
Jenny had another yeah. comment.
Part of what they talked about in our training involving local law enforcement is that when you involve local law enforcement, their question is, does that become a training for the teachers and the staff and the students, or does that become a training for the law enforcement? Because they should be two separate trainings. They should be two separate things. And then something else that they talked about is when they do the site assessments is what is the path of least resistance? What is the path of least resistance? Where is a shooter likely to go? And that's different in every building. And another thing they touched on that I guess I didn't think about is, you know, if you are in lockdown, if it is active shooter, where at in that room should the teacher huddle the students? Because if you're huddled in the wrong corner, and I think that's, maybe the teachers have all thought about it and they've had training on that, I don't know, but they were just things as a parent that I hope that my child knows that if they're on lockdown, that Hayden shouldn't go to the back corner where the playhouse is, that they should be, you know, in the front corner by the rocking chair. Whatever that may be, I guess I just feel like that's part of their assessment and that's part of their preparedness training. And I just think that it's really important that, I think they go hand in hand. I think they go hand in hand. I think that the in-person training would make everybody feel prepared and understand the site assessments after they happen.
Jenny, you said that that was a 2-hour training course for everybody. And that was it, just a 2-hour training?
No, and they tried hard to get as much as they could into 2 hours. They actually had, they were in the Dells the next day, and our HR person had went to, they had welcomed her to come and listen to an 8-hour training that they had done the next day with, I think that was a corporate group. I'm unsure of who that was for, but.
And if you would like more than 2 hours, she's.
Oh, yeah, I think their training for a school would definitely, I think it would definitely be for more than 2 hours. And like I said, I thought it was gonna be total snooze fest, and it was awesome.
Here's my opinion on this, okay. 2 hours, 8 hours, 3 days, doesn't matter. The situation happens, people are gonna go, what we call in the military, in the black. They're gonna, doesn't matter. I mean, we train day after day after day after day. And it, some guys, some people, it doesn't matter. I mean, it's, and that's just the God's honest truth. I'm not saying that Blue U is not a good company. I'm just saying that's another thing to consider. Some people can handle the stress. Some people, they could have 2 years of straight training and they get in that situation. And it doesn't matter. It's a fog of war. So that's just my two cents on that. I'm not saying it's not a good training, not a good site assessment. But again, and everybody reacts differently. So that's just my thoughts.
Can I ask two questions?
Sure.
Has EMC or Blue U worked with a school that after they've done their assessments that has had a situation arise? So has either one done a, either ahead of time or after, done an assessment of a school, a business? And just kind of how does that play into the whole conversation? How much more prepared were they one versus the other? That's
a good question, but apparently the safety committee didn't think they were even worth vetting, so Jenny and I did that, so. And it looks like we're probably going to get turned down again by that. So
the safety committee had already concluded their work and made their recommendations to the board. I shared with the board that we're going to take the summer to vet. There's at least 3 really highly recommended companies, Blue U would be one of them, that offers active shooting training services. We would put together and score on a rubric a lot of different factors about the comprehensiveness of the training, the recommendations that come from the cost, the ability to travel. And we'll bring a recommendation back to the board that you can totally discuss and act on, because it most likely will be an item in excess of $5,000 that will need board approval. And you can vet all of the vendors at that point. I think bringing it back to the agenda item today is, do we want to include a secure entrance at the high school, middle school location this summer as part of the school safety grant? Or do you want to pass on that opportunity at this time and look to other opportunities?
Is there a reason that we couldn't have just added Blue U or one of those other companies in with this proposal?
The active shooting training is not an eligible grant-funded expense.
But we would be covering the remainder, so that would be eligible, then, correct? Because they're not under the grant, but out of our out-of-pocket.
Right, if we wanted to utilize the options that I put forward to the board, which would be fund balance, referendum, potential future cost savings in other budgets, in future budgets, yes, that could be possible. We don't have a line item in this current budget.
Is there a deadline on that grant application?
It had to be submitted June 8th, I think.
Oh, full service.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So I'm just going to note that 2 females recommended this company, and that if another silent board member or a silent parent can come in and say what they want and those things get done, I'm noting that right now.
I just want to repeat what I shared with Jenny on the phone and as well to you, Kelly, is that Blue U will be one of the vendors that we are going to score on a rubric against other companies and vendors that provide a similar service. There are a lot of different approaches. Some of them have a lot of common overlap, but there's some very small techniques that vary between each approach. And I think we want to vet those and look at how those approaches differ and ultimately put a comprehensive solution that doesn't just train staff, but it also trains students and trains parents. Those are all the stakeholders that would respond in an active shooter event. So Blue U will definitely be considered as one of those vendors that we'll closely look at over the summer.
I fully support an assessment of our buildings. And I do not endorse Blue U, like we're yeah. going down the path of vetting three or four different vendors. And whether it happens this summer, this fall, the secured entrance may happen before they even do their assessment. I don't know. I would like to see a secured entrance at this building as we put in the elementary. And I think 120,000, what we're talking about, is a little high for that too. I think we can break this project down into a couple of different phases.
I agree with everything you just said, and I also agree with Kelly that it's like, I'm not so sure that we shouldn't try to get an expert in here to actually look at that, because we may be putting this completely out of whack in comparison to what we really should be doing.
I would really like to see somebody that has experience with schools if we're going to go.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Who are the other companies that the board plans on vetting, if I can ask?
They are.
I would just like to do some other.
Yeah. The schools just don't seek them out.
I'll send you a list, Jenny, along with the board, and I can send you links to each one of the others that I think are nice to consider right out of the gates.
Thank you.
So, does anybody care to make a motion?
Yes. So,
what are we acting on, Jeff?
Whether or not we want to.
This is a grant application, correct?
Well, it's a grant application. So, what do you want for item of action? Why is it under there? Because technically you've already
applied for it, right?
Right, but there's a...
I think it's to roll the project into into the current roof project to use cost savings for the people that are the site manager or whatever that's already here. So I think if we want to look into changing it, skimming it down, whatever, if we want to get those cost savings, we may want to do that.
So the motion would be to amend the current contract with FEH to include a secured entrance.
So that was decided at the committee, the finance committee?
No, that was a recommendation brought forward here.
By whom?
The chairs of the operation and finance committee.
So just to recap again how we got to this point, you know.
Did you send out an email to inform all of us on this?
I did. Yeah. It was an open invitation, joint meeting of Operations Finance Committee. So the topic at hand was, number one, the safety grant is due June 8th. Should we apply for money to pay for a secure entrance at the middle school, high school, which has been generally agreed upon that our current entrance is not secured and all visitors need to be directed through the office in a secure fashion. And there was a design by Nexus, and there was this design that Luke displayed, which I think was an FEH proposal, right? Which was
and we're using money from Nexus estimate from when?
No, so the question was, should we apply for money with the safety grant that's due June 8th to help pay for that entrance, knowing that the max we were most likely to get was $20,000 per site. So counting three sites would be $60,000. And the current estimate for a secured entrance for this building at its most basic, without doing a whole lot of room shifting, was like 124, whatever's in the 129, 448. And so the question to the two committees, and correct me if I'm wrong, was that, you know, should we apply for this $60,000 and find a way to come up with the rest of the funds to fund this whole entrance project before the beginning of next school year?
or should we not apply for it at all, or should we apply for the full amount, which would be above the max, how would you describe
threshold.
That? Basically, direct that was advised through the grant, knowing that if we applied for more than what was advised as the proposed limit per site, it may get rejected out of hand. We would get zero money from the grant towards this project. So the operations committees voted to approve the design of this secure entrance
by
FEH, and to be coupled with the FEH roof project, which is happening currently, so that we can save money on costs, supplies, contractors, everyone who's already on site at this campus. And that was gonna, that's what's gonna bring the cost of everything down. Yeah.
Do we have a breakdown on that?
Yes.
By now?
Yes.
Did we ever vote on that, or we just discussed it?
Well,
we kind of,
it's like a recommendation.
You can't vote on it.
We kind of,
so it's like a recommendation to the board.
I get it.
And so that's what we're voting on. Is that a fair summary?
Yeah. But there was things too that we, if we're gonna move forward, kind of as Larry said, we need to maybe trim out or redesign some options that maybe didn't need to be to cut costs, so.
So are we?
Did we get information on the breakdown from FEH? Yeah.
For the
I don't think FEH is even in the loop yet.
Yes, they are. They've designed and they created a budget.
Now you are.
Yeah. So they made the design. They created an initial budget, which would have to be sent out for bids. Obviously, that's just a budget number. It's not the actual cost of the project. There'd be further refinement of the project once the board approves that we're going forward with the project. But before we got into a lot of refinement and taking all of these comments, I have already received comments from office staff and have incorporated some of those preliminary thoughts and changes into some of the conceptual drawings as they're waiting for the board to act on. Is this actually going to happen this summer or not? At that point, a finalized proposal would come forward with some of those decisions, corrections around the detention rooms and other areas. But we need to just step back and say, are we going forward with the project this summer so that we have a secured entrance in the fall when we come back, or not? The funding, if it should come through, could still be done the year after next. It does allow us for the grant to be done through the summer of 2019. So that's a possibility. However, if it's not funded, we wouldn't have capital dollars built in the 18-19 budget. So at earliest, it would start summer of 1920.
So I have a question. When this was all questioned last year by the operations committee and we wanted a more secure entrance and all that, why wasn't that proceeded now? Why all of a sudden the rush? I mean, why is it different than, why did we wait until now to do it?
Two pieces. The school safety grant came about and the legislature passed that following a school shooting in the country. So this spring, they were defining the rules and the parameters of that grant. It was a very short window to actually write that grant with a deadline of June 8th. And the second piece is that we could not have anticipated, but there is a windfall that we can recognize by coupling this project with the roof project, because we already have masons on site. We already have a site coordinator. There would only be one deployment fee versus coming back next year. We wouldn't be able to leverage any of those costs. You'd be reduplicating or replicating those. So talking with Mitch from Kramer Brothers, he is very confident that the proposal that FEH put forward can be reduced because of those cost savings in the project, coupled with the school safety grant, is what makes this a timely decision for the board.
Well, and if we pass this, if we don't think that there's a big enough savings, we can then put it on a back burner, could we not, and bid out to other contractors next year?
If the board doesn't approve tonight, I think you're looking at a 1920 project at the earliest. There is a lot of lead time that needs for ordering of things like doors, frames, windows, or glass specifically for this project. That's going to take a significant amount of lead time, and the state permitting process is laborious and cumbersome, and that needs to start immediately upon board approval. If we don't have those things and we're kind of shifting for a little bit, then it's best to just try to schedule this project at a later date with the dollars that are known from the grant and or some other funding source.
So hypothetically, if we get the 60,000,
that technically is for three buildings, we can spend all that 60 on one building. Is that correct?
That is correct. You can pool all 60 together for one building, and that was the way the grant was written based on the committee feedback in operations and finance prior to the June 8th deadline. I would recommend going forward with this project at this time only because of the cost savings that would be duplicated next year with the same project. It not only will cost more for inflationary prices, but it will also cost more in the duplication of services.
How much was the savings?
It couldn't be anticipated at this time, other than Mitch was able to say there would be significant savings. So he didn't label specifically what the cost of a supervisor is, their mobility and deployment of their equipment, and the savings that the masons on site could continue on and do work. That wasn't put into an actual number yet, but he was confident that those savings were there.
Is it a guarantee we're going to get the $20,000 per building?
No.
Who's this Mitch we're talking about? So they're not confused that it's that Mitch.
Mitch is a vice president of operations at Kramer. Mitch is
a... I'm not sure that's his title, but he's working on the review.
Just make it clear, we're not talking about...
Greg Cal is the vice president.
Mitch DeBrey.
So, I have a question.
Mitch Gilbert, I don't know if you talked to Mitch or DeBrey.
Through Kevin, talked to Mitch, so we got an email correspondence chain down the road.
So we're at $129,000. If the grant comes in at $30,000, do we still move ahead?
That's the question.
Or can I come back to the board? Because, I mean, it's going to make a big difference if we don't get the $60,000, because then we're popping up a lot more money. Mm-hmm. So we really don't have right now.
Whether we should make a contingent on whether we get awarded the full amount.
It's my thought.
We need a secure front entryway. It is not that way now. And I think the insurance company...
Well, the doors are technically locked all the time. Of course, unfortunately, we know that's not always the case. But.
No.
So I've been asked, I asked, maybe 2 years ago in November about all these safety issues and all of that, and if we are, liable for that, and no one could answer that. So that's a good question. Let's put it before the board.
Somebody want to make a motion?
I make a motion that we do that. Go ahead with this. We obviously must have applied for the grant money and take it June 8th. That we fold this into the roof project so that we get both a secured entrance and the roof done at the same time. If we should get significantly less than, let's say, $30,000, we get to... how soon do you find out about the grant, by the way?
It's unknown. I checked on another grant similar to this, and the release date for funding was August, but that doesn't necessarily say when the notification of the grant is.
Then I won't add anything to it. I'll just say pass it as it is.
Can't we put on there that there is also included or funds made additional for the preparedness company?
That was something we can't apply for in the grants. You know, I see to this general funding you want to do?
I think
he was going to get the vetting done of the different companies.
I think that piece might be more appropriate in the preliminary budget and approval of that. There's an opportunity to look at addressing that inside of the budget.
Because we're really voting on amending a contract with FEH, correct?
Correct.
Correct.
But we still don't know the revised, that's the issue, my issue. We don't know the revised plan. And the revised cost, because for $129,000,
I mean... You know a cost not to exceed, it's a budget. It's not an actual project cost.
I understand.
And you won't get any of those actual costs until it goes up to bid with a final project or concept that's approved. It could be by the operations board.
So we're betting on considerable savings and $60,000. We're hedging our bet on $60,000 and considerable savings.
Or we're determining that this is something that we want done either way, and it doesn't fit into the current budget, or if it's for next year's budget, that's taking, as we know already, we're at max, so we're then going to have to find $130,000 in savings next year on top of increased costs to do it in next year's budget. So to me, this is a good use of fund balance, if we're going to use fund balance. I think this is a project
a large portion of the community is behind. It's come up multiple times. I think maybe if we include contingent on operation committee approval of design or something like that.
That'd be good.
So they have to come back to us and you get to work with them and all Larry's concerns may be addressed. Some of the things we've heard about moving the security resource officer, the police liaison to the front of the building, we may get to address. But I think the real question is do we want this project done or not?
The problem I have, Andy, is not the secure entrance, but the complete office remodel, that's where I have a problem with it. It's not tied to this, the secure entrance.
Well, I think that's where contingent on operation committee, it's operations committee, if you guys want to meet, or if you want to meet as a board and pare it down to what we think
and
is.
And break it down into phases, and I believe that 60,000 would give us the secure entrance we need. And yeah, it might not be perfect, it might not be the best. We're not dealing with 700 people walking through that entrance.
Because approval would give us...
During non-school hours.
Right. Would give us move forward with say, permits and stuff and planning.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Without a design in place.
And are we going to come up with the source for the balance, the shortfall of this project tonight? Is that going to be part of your motion, Doug?
No.
When does that get addressed?
We should probably get a second to that motion if we're going to further discuss it. Otherwise, if there is no second, then it can move on.
I'll second that.
Okay. Is that with the contingency of the operation committee approving your design?
That's fine. That'd be great.
Okay.
I'd agree with that.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there any more comments?
I guess to answer Kelly's question, I would assume that we would decide what to do, how to pay for it once we figure out how much grant award we get and how much savings is in the final bid.
Yeah.
My comment is that the front door is like a flat tire. I think you need to fix it really quickly. It is so porous, it's inexcusable for a school.
Well, that discussion's been going on for 12 months, so.
Well, I think now's the time to make a change.
Working with grant writers, we've been given the assurances that the 60,000 we wrote for is not in excess of and should be approved as a second wave of funding. After primary funding, there's an advanced funding. Then there's kind of a tertiary or third wave of funding. And if we had asked for the full project, they thought that there was little to no chance of having that project actually be reimbursed. So I feel comfortable and confident with the amount of money that the state has set aside, that there will be that 60,000 so that the district's portion would be $60,000 or less.
Okay, there's no more discussion. Let's call a question.
Bush.
Yes.
Chambers.
Yes.
Dunn.
Yes.
Dunlop.
Epstein.
Lindsay.
Yes.
Steffes.
Yes.
Bastin.
Yes.
601. We should go back. We did not approve minutes, so I just want to get that on the
table. We have a motion to approve the minutes.
Motion.
Hold on a second.
Second.
Do you want to call the question on that one?
Sure. Bush? Or you want to just call it? You can call the question and just roll. Just all in favor, or I can do a roll call.
All in favor?
Aye.
Yes. Any opposed? Motion carried. Elementary school building plan.
We have provided answers to some of your questions with regards to questions you had in the last meeting with regards to code requirements for K-4, bus lane improving the baseball field, seating capacity of the gym, cost of a baseball diamond, and how to move 4K. The additional information that is provided, Christy's here, she can answer some questions, give you some further information in any of these areas as we know it at this date. Just want to review for the board that in the packet is the final results of the survey, the addition and remodel breakdown and costs as you go through the different levels, and the percentage of approval showing more than half favorable both with students in the district and without students in the district, more than half favorable with all of the measures that are being proposed. And the new document for the board this particular meeting is the mill rate analysis. And at the top line, I shared with the board, and I believe this is on page 17 of, it starts with page 17 in your board packet. The mill rate currently, last year was 1246, this year's 1243, and last year's 1243, this year's 1209, and it continues to drop as we go forward based on what we know and what we project to be true going forward. We know that the project, if we did all of the measures, is $11.92 million. That adds roughly $2.09 or $2.10 in any given year to the mill rate. So if we look at the difference that our drop is over the year 2018, our current rate, 1209, with the mill rate going down and then adding in a project, the net is 1338 in the first year of 2019. The net is 1333 in the second year and 1330 in the third year. So as you look at that net increase, it translates into a monthly increase of $16 per medium household income of $150,000. If you looked at last year's mill rate, it would actually be a difference of $11.88 on a $150,000 home. That's important because the survey in the tax threshold of the 375 people or more that responded said they could weather a project at the school with a remodel in the $12 to $16 range was where the majority of the surveyed members stated that their tax threshold was. Some were willing to go higher, some not as high, but that $12 to $16 tended to be the potential best point of entry for what a possible project would show. So I think the mill rate analysis shows that we can stay within those thresholds and do the complete project. The project itself is before the board. I did also load up the bond consult so you can actually see the payment schedule. There's, now that we know the actual amount, there's a scenario A and a scenario B. The scenario B is actually two bonds that kind of overlap each other and gives you a more favorable result on the mill rate. So I would recommend, if the board went forward with the project, to look at a two bond scenario. Lastly is just a timing for the board. I wanted to share just some counsel that I got from, again, we worked with Quarles and Brady on our bond counsel. And I wanted to share a document that on one side gives a bond referendum timetable, which I'll send to each board member. On the back side is basically a sample resolution of what it would look like if you went forward with the resolution. Both of these are important because as the board contemplates next steps, if we look backwards from the August date that we need to have a resolution by, typically what happens is you put the proposed resolution on an agenda in the month prior to the time where you're actually acting on the final resolution. So for this board, you would potentially want to have a resolution solidified by July. You can have some discussion around that. Community members can come in and speak to that resolution. It may be modified or not, depending on what the board hears and from the community. And then in the August meeting is the final resolution that is voted up or down by the board as to whether to go forward and secure bonds through the form of a referendum. So this meeting is pretty important for the board to start to get down to what a possible referendum resolution might be. How much does it include? How far do you go in that process? You have committee members here. You have Christy with FEH here. We have a wealth of information at your disposal. This is a time for the board to further discuss, and it would be prudent to start to take some action to define the project so we can bring the appropriate resolution at the appropriate amount back for the board to consider. I put on the backside two sample resolutions. One is for the bonds itself, which would be an elementary school remodeling. It does show the resolution with an $11,920,000 borrowing bond to do the full remodel project as proposed for the board. But that number is subject to change as the board decides which projects would or would not go forward. The second is a similar resolution, but it's the opportunity for, in when asking a question, to look at operating costs. If the board wanted to build in potential operating costs for things like technology, school safety, or capital maintenance, budgets that we've not been able to hold in this budget because of our budget reductions, this is an opportunity to consider that as well. It's It's not a requirement that you go forward with operations. It's just an opportunity for you to consider if you do want to go forward with operations, what an amount might be and what you'd use that for. The reason I bring that up is part of our operations and in finance committee discussion was once we get the entrance secured at the front, just equally as important as the back entrance to the ag building that still leaves us vulnerable and exposed. And that project to enclose would take some dollars. And we have not been able to build in a substantial capital budget to attack that problem in any given year, like the secured entrance. So this might be an opportunity to look at not just this measure, but future measures, because there's other alternatives that we have passed on year to year in operations because we don't have the money. So I will turn it over to the board for discussion and potential action. If you have any needs, just recalling that Leah and Christy are here as the committee chair and FEH resources.
Could we go through the questions we posed and the answers to those questions about the baseball
sure.
park? And
yep. Just lost it. Come on back. So the first question that was proposed was the exact code requirements for K-4 students not being on the second floor. Christy, are you able to go any deeper than the response that
yes.
we received today?
Actually, it's chapter 15 of the Life Safety Code. And if you, I didn't bring copies for everybody, do you want me to read you what the requirement is?
No.
Okay. Because it refers
to
preschool, kindergarten, and first grade students located on a level of exit discharge is specifically what it states. And it's just primarily so that the little kids can get out and don't have to deal with the larger, faster children going the same direction.
Second question was on the bus lane impeding the current baseball field. In Kevin's early assessment, and Kevin is traveling on vacation, so he sent this prior to his departure, but Christy is here to give more clarification.
I may not be able to provide a whole lot of clarification. Can you refresh? I'm sorry, I wasn't present at that meeting. What exactly was the question? Was it the bus lane at the elementary school currently in?
Would it impede on the current baseball field?
Okay, in terms of the size of the current baseball field?
Right. And Kevin's response at that time was that it would not impede any more than the current track does. That lane is essentially the same lane that would be used for a road to come through in on. And as much as that impedes the baseball diamond, so would a bus entrance.
I would stand by that statement at this point. I'm sorry, I don't have much more to add. We did look at other ball diamond locations, but I don't have any costing related to that. We just looked at how they would lay out on the site with the three different options proposed that were mentioned at the last school board meeting, so I apologize.
Can we refresh? That lane would be right out of the old Ivy House, right? If you're looking at it on the backyard? Yeah, okay.
The seating capacity was asked. I think this is a question Jeff had brought up twice. The average seat in a four, I believe this is a four row unit, 64 seats in a row, 256 seats is what is scheduled. They're about 24 inches per row. So if you want to add a row or reduce a row, you can roughly estimate 64 seats per row, and then you can adjust your 256 up or down from there. The cost of the baseball diamond, I know you've been doing work, and it's a function of the location.
I have some preliminary drawings, but I don't have enough grading information, so I was going to take a look at that today, see if I could get a little bit more information before I want to give you better numbers.
The elementary staff did look at if we move the 4K to the main level, what would be the best solution if we tried to work within our confines of the building as it exists? The best option is to move the elementary to the top level and move the students to the lower level. Just flip-flop those two spaces.
Library.
Library and 4K would be just a change upstairs, downstairs. They're roughly the same spaces, just above and below each other. Moving the elementary, library, could be a costly expense. It's not just the books, it's all of the computer drops and the electrical and the lighting and so forth that goes with that.
There is a dedicated restroom for the little kids up there, just outside the classrooms, and that's something we want to consider, how to best serve the little kids from bathroom functionalities.
I know the elementary leadership team met and discussed this. There were some other options that were floated out there but not considered to be real viable, but this was the best option. And it was kind of a moot point if there was going to be a remodel. They didn't want to do a lot of legwork on shifting a lot of classes around. For instance, art and music could be flipped and maybe something off of that entrance, which is still technically the second level, but exits off of the main exit, but it's opposite of the side of the playground and creates other challenges. So there's lots of different uniquenesses of it, but ultimately the IMC library flipping with the 4K room was the best solution.
And we discussed that we thought that was necessary for the fall. Is that, refresh my memory?
You knew we were trying to do something by fall.
Our recommendation would be not to disrupt the flow. If you have a plan in place and that includes a remodel, that you wouldn't disrupt everything for a year to disrupt it again a second year or a third year to get to the final end product. We just leave the status quo, knowing that there is a solution. I think that's one of the things that they ask for when you're trying to show compliance, is that there's a plan to meet that compliance. Right now we don't have a plan.
Except if you have a pre-K, if you have a four-year-old coming in. So
right.
As a parent, so
understood.
Teachers are talking about how they feel about it. We're talking about how we feel about it. We have to consider those parents that have those children coming in.
Yeah.
I mean, I think that's the first thing.
It would be and that was just the point I wanted to make, is if we had a plan, it wouldn't be necessary for us to make a move in year one, but it certainly would be costly, and those are not costs that we have built into the budget, so it would have to be part of a referendum question, and if there's a referendum question, then I'm not sure you want to build an additional cost for 1 year, but that's for the board to decide.
And what happens if the referendum fails? Then you no longer have a plan in place.
Then we would have to revert back to the plan to look at the LMC and Azure 8 and 4K actually moving. And we'd have to plan for a budget around that.
So what are you looking for from the board right now?
I think it would be wise for the board to take a look at the document that's addition and remodel for breakdown. What you'll see in this, I think this is a very important document for the board to consider. Over 375 surveys, level of support, both for those that have kids in school and for those kids that do not have school. And this is in rank order. So if you look at the code and the maintenance ADA items, and this is ordered by the students or those that have kids in school. So the number one priority for people is to 87% support a code maintenance ADA fix. That is the most, and actually more people than 87-88% without kids actually support that measure as well. So you have a very strong support for that first item. Moving down then, the next important item to people in the survey was to renovate and update the existing elementary first floor. That includes the fourth floor settling issue, the second floor, and some minor finishes. 70% of all respondents with kids and without kids supported that measure. The parking, bus lane, storm water was the next on the staff and or parent. Those with children in the district, 69% were in favor of that initiative, and still a good strong majority of 65% without kids support that measure. Securing the lobby, the office, the classroom addition, 69% of students with kids tied for the parking, bus lane, stormwater for those that have kids in school. 71%, again higher, with those that don't have kids in school, would like to see those additional classrooms and office spaces. The last is the gym PE addition. Again, a majority of people with kids, 66%, and a majority of people without kids, 61%, could support that measure. As you look to the right then, I think the next important piece is the running total. If you do just the first line item, and I can just highlight that, and only did the thing that had 87 and 88% support respectively, the project cost $2,175,000. If you take and run that down to the next highest level of support, which is also to renovate and update the existing elementary school, first floor, second floor, the project total then increases to $5,162,000. That includes the ADA that we're assuming you're doing in rank order and the next step in line, which is the renovation. Likewise, with the parking, secure classroom additions, and secure office lobby, those together bump the project up to $7 million and then $9,600,000 respectively. Those could be interchanged. We could figure out the difference, and you might prioritize one over the other. And then the last cutoff for the full amount of the project is the gym and PE. So I think the discussion for the board is, where is the cut line, if there is a cut line, and what might be the project that you'd like to see go forward that we put in a rough draft of a resolution in July. People could come forward, speak to it, give you some input, and then the final resolution would come forward in August if you chose a resolution at all.
So I think, sorry, go ahead.
On the renovate and update existing elementary for approximately $4.2 million, what are we giving for that, other than a level four, I guess?
Can you take that one, Christy? Like, what's wrapped up in the renovation and update of existing elementary? I know it was, okay. I mean, we've got some documents I could go back and kind of list the line items out in that.
I think part of the major renovation was addressing classroom size for a few of the classrooms, so we would actually be reworking some classrooms in the area. If you hold on a brief moment, I'll see if I can find my breakdown and might be able to answer your question in more detail.
So that would be switching the pre-K downstairs, so that's also part of it.
The floor.
Yeah, the floor.
The floor ceiling.
All the classroom sizes, some of the toilet room stuff is in that as well.
A lot of it was bathroom fixtures, as well as some different flooring things that needed to be addressed. There were some outside things to the building in terms of some masonry things that needed to be addressed too, I think.
That brings air conditioning into the mix.
Is that with air conditioning? Mm-hmm. And updated boilers too.
I believe that was part of that. Mm-hmm. I have to pull up the actual document that has the line item of all those building improvement measures, but I don't want to digress unless you really need that for the next piece of this discussion.
While we're looking that up, Luke, I got a question on the mill rate.
Okay.
On your documents from PMA, the workup, it appeared that the monthly increase is going to be roughly 26 or 27, depending on what plan you chose as far as bonds. On your workup, you were saying it's 16 net increase.
Yeah, the difference from our current mill rate to what the new mill rate would be. So I can pull that document back up.
So this is off of the existing mill rate?
Yeah, this is off of the 1209. Yeah, so the difference between, so if we know that our mill rate's projected to go to 1129, and if we add a referendum question, it would cost $2.09 in its first year, based on bond council. To your point, that's a pretty conservative estimate using a pretty conservative interest rate. I think we can do better on that when we actually shop the market, but we're kind of being, 209 is probably on the high end, is my point.
It's also using the split bond.
It is, it's using the split bond method.
Right.
That total mill rate increase is $13.38, and that $13.38 represents $1.29 over our current mill rate.
Okay.
So that, when I look at our current mill rate, what does that do to our monthly net increase? $16 per month on a $150 home. And if we look back just 1 year ago to what we were paying in taxes a year ago in 2017, would actually be an $11.88 per month increase over what we were paying in last year's taxes per month on an average home or median home of 150. Again, what that includes then is all of these items fully funded at that net dollar.
Raising the mill rate to about 13.5,
yeah,
is what it would do.
So I mean, I think the first question in my mind is, do we, and this might seem obvious, but do we remodel the elementary school at the current site? You know, do we accept the recommendations from the planning committee? It sounds like that's the direction we're heading. So I mean, that's the first question. Do we do this at the current site? Then I think the second question is, how much do we do in the project? You know, as far as all of this or parts of it. In my mind, the cutoff is at the 7 million mark here with the running total. And the reason I'm thinking that is because, it's just for the cutoff mark. So we gotta do the, get everything up to code. I think if we're gonna remodel the current site, we have to take care of the settling floor and the foundation. You know, I suppose we could take classroom upgrades out of that, but that's a fraction. The majority of that cost of that renovation is the floor foundation. And then I think if we're gonna redo the floor foundation, we have to redirect the stormwater to keep it from settling again, right? And I don't know if we can separate the stormwater resolution with parking bus lane, but I feel like if we take care of the foundation, we gotta take care of the cause of the foundation, which is the stormwater coming in under the foundation from the north end. So that's where I think is the minimum of the project in my mind. And then, you know, we can debate whether to do a secure lobby, you know, and how much more secure than what it's currently made. I don't know if we have to change the entrance, you know, from the east side to the west side, or what the proposal would be, you know, as far as expanding offices and classrooms. You know, I think those can be.
Well, Aaron, I think the way they've got the bus route comes in that way, and that's part of
you
the
move
entry.
The entrance.
Yeah.
Yeah, I get what you're saying. Yeah. So that may be, you know, tied to where the
I
bus
think
lane
the
is.
Other, the other concern in that being a line, because I think your line of thinking is good, but correct me if I'm wrong, is in widening the classrooms, the idea was we would lose a classroom or two because we were adding them elsewhere in the full picture. So if in that number of the second option, I think, includes larger classrooms.
And
but the result, of that is recovering
lost classrooms. I got you.
Is additional classrooms.
We have Mind Link this evening. That's where I was going. There's a bit of a ripple effect associated with not doing one piece, which would then influence kind of how you would renovate the existing building. Because part of the functionality of the addition means that we can make larger classrooms in the existing building. So if we didn't do the classroom addition, then it would be more of a fixing the floor and minor renovation component in the existing.
Mm-hmm.
Just so everybody's aware kind of about that.
Yeah, thank you. Mm-hmm.
Why is it?
Can we do a split level with this? Can we do a split level screen with the cost and this plan?
I think so.
How is the gym not under the code violation? Because I keep getting told that that's one of the major code violations, and that's completely separate from the code and the ADA items.
Well, the clear space on the around the perimeter and the floor transition into the space.
The gym in general.
In terms of,
because you've got that down at the very bottom, and it's like it's all there on its own, but that's part of the code violation is that we really have no gym at the elementary.
I think, if you don't mind me jumping in, part of it was with the way that the survey was laid out and the questions, the way that we asked them, because we asked people for support of different things. So those were the things we specifically asked them for support for, and so that's how they rank ordered and supported them. I'm not sure that it addresses your specific question.
No, it doesn't, because it's a code violation, so it should be in with the codes.
Well, it's an insurance thing, and it's a floor transition related to ADA, so you can still use it as a multi-purpose room. You simply can't use it as a court.
It gets smaller. Does that help? Well, I like seeing that.
Well, in that workup there, though, it looks like if we add,
at a gym and the lobby, new entrance, then the baseball field would get relocated. Which we do not have that.
With using this design, correct?
So first floor, so I, when you say ripple effect, when we say that renovate and update existing elementary, that doesn't include that addition in the entrance in the pink left?
It's just the orange.
And yep.
The code main, the renovate and update existing elementary is the orange and the yellow. It doesn't include the red.
It doesn't
the
include
pink,
the red.
Pink red.
Okay, so
the pink red is the secure lobby office classroom addition and the
okay.
Gym.
Okay. So Aaron, you were, that was what we thought we could discuss, is the secure lobby office classroom addition.
Yeah, I'm just trying to just
it's easy to see this. Yeah, and it's easy to see it when the numbers are there and you can assign that to it.
But the parts are all connected to the whole. Unfortunately, you're losing space in the old building by creating larger class size. So
right.
You need the additional space.
Right.
And then that then begets a new entryway because of the bus route. So in a sense, the whole project is tied together. I mean, that's what they did, which is a normal engineering concept, you know. I don't see how you can pick and choose on this these items. I mean, it's kind of a package here, unfortunately. The arm's connected to the shoulder, you know, so it's just the way it is. I don't know how you can parse it out myself.
You could potentially consider phasing. I'm the last person who would
But phasing would require more than one bond issue and more than
right,
one referendum.
Right, but it would reduce your referendum dollar ask.
I hate
if
to
that
peck
them
to death. It's like being pecked to death by chickens. I think if you try to do one thing and one time do it properly, you're better off than multiple bond issues. So,
I would agree with that statement. I would just.
I mean, as a voter, I would see, if I see multiple bond issues, I'd say, what are they doing? They're not planning sufficiently.
Well, and I'm trying to do a 10-year picture here, too.
Yeah.
So,
part of the plan for the
not just here, no.
Part of the plan for the committee was not to just offer a 2-year or a 5-year plan, but to really think about the fact that the building has lasted for 50 years. And there have been things that have been done. Clearly, budgets are limited, so we do what we can with what we have. But to give us a 50-year solution, once again, and looking at what we need in terms of both education and space, as well as safety concerns and the things that we know today. Now, we all know that the variables will change as we move forward, and none of us can plan for those things, so we go with the best information that we have, and that's the way we got to the recommendation that we have today. So, I just kind of want to add that to your conversation.
Thank you. 50-year, did you say?
That was the discussion. It's a good theory, right? So, it's
well,
probably...
it seems a bit high.
Well, in a sense, this would be
the
original building. Here we are 50 years later
65.
Facing the issue now. So I think they did a good job 50 years ago, you know, myself.
And I think that
yeah,
the board...
Yeah, new whole new set of parameters to assess.
And I bet they did then, too.
Well, if we're going to pay this amount of money, I would hope it lasts close to 50 years.
Yeah.
You know, I don't want to be coming back 20 years later and saying we need to fix the roof again.
Yeah.
Right?
I'll try to stick around, but
I guess where I'm at, regardless of what I think is right to be done, should be done, based on the participate, those who chose to participate, and I understand everybody has the right to a voice, but those who chose to voice their opinion is, I'm in favor of asking the whole question, because that is what the people who chose to participate in the survey are in favor of. So regardless of my personal opinion, I will make that a motion.
Okay, we have a motion. Does somebody want a second?
I'll second.
Any further discussion?
Yeah.
Yes.
I got some questions. Going back to that mill rate, our general operating budget is getting close to being a negative, and we know that whether it's next year, the way it's going, 2 years for sure, I think we're going to be looking at additional funds. Mm-hmm.
So if we increase our mill rate to 13.5 with this project, then we got to go back again to the community. Not that things stay status quo. You know, we could be approaching that $15 mark, and I tell you what, people on this board is going to be some money. We're not going to be friends of the community if people are going to start paying $15 a thousand for the mill rate.
Well, that's been my concern all along. Is
I would like to address our operating budget first, so then we can add this on. And I personally don't think 1250 or 13 is a bad number, but
without having that number,
right?
To it's just a holistic approach.
And I cannot support any additions until we know we're comfortable with what we have going forward.
My part of the discussion is my personal bias was for a new school, and I've come around to this concept. The idea of my head, a new school, you've got all the things that you say, both energy, efficiency, stuff that doesn't have to be repaired quite as soon. It's still some of the old existing stuff in this building. But I think the voters, like Andy has said, those that have expressed themselves, have clearly expressed themselves for this option. And I think the costs are within the realm of what the community can handle. I can't predict the future, and so I think this is something that needs to be done. I too worry about long-term costs and things, but I'm not sure that we can address those at all.
And I support Larry's concern. I mean, I'd like to see us have a strategy to correct our structural deficit so that we can have, you know, so that we don't come up with having to drive the mill rate up to 15 and, you know, with another referendum in 2-3 years. So,
as early as next year, possibly.
Right, or even this year. I mean, we could add an operational recurring referendum alongside this as an option. So it'd be nice to maybe have a plan to at least a tentative plan to offset that structural deficit. So, but I mean, I would support Andy's motion maybe with that contingency that we have a plan for, you know, for our structural deficit, you know, before we go to referendum. You know, I don't think we have to decide on a resolution tonight. You know what I mean? But we're kind of whittling it down to what a rough resolution would look like. So
I don't want to link those together either. Mm-hmm. We vote on that separate. I don't want to link that together.
Okay, I think that's fair.
That's good advice. And I think you're both absolutely right. And you know, we've talked about it a couple meetings in a row. We have to come up with some long-term solutions. If we pair that with this motion, we're giving ourselves 30 days to have a full plan to fix that. Mm-hmm. And I think we're looking at a lot of work over this fiscal year to make sure we're in a good spot next fiscal year and moving forward, including decisions we have in front of us tonight.
Mm-hmm.
So that would be my concern, is to say that needs to be in place and to be able to meet this timeline we're giving ourselves.
And a realistic timeline, you think, for discerning that strategy?
Because I think if it was done in 30 days, we would have done it in the last 2 months.
Fair.
If it was that simple.
Yeah.
In fact, we have kind of a timeline about the bonding issue, too.
Right.
Unfortunately.
I'm familiar with, yeah, I definitely don't want to jeopardize the timeline.
So
I appreciate that.
With your remark, I really would feel more comfortable linking the two, because we're already in the hole and we know we're in the hole, and we're crazy if we think we're going to be able to stabilize that. The money isn't there. We've been going at it for years, ever since the last referendum.
So
let me interject before, because I think it can help bring some clarity to this.
I'm just afraid that one decision isn't going to, I mean, how do we do that?
I know where
you're
going.
I mean, if I say no to this, it's because I didn't know about that.
Exactly.
Do you know what I mean? Like, I don't, and then what, I'm not sure I'm making the best decision.
Well, even
does that make sense?
The survey results did not know, the people that took them surveys did not know about our operating budget and the potential deficit.
But the deficit.
Yeah, they didn't know that when they were.
But they will when they evolve.
That's why bring, just, if we bring it to light.
Right, that's why I'm just, well, I think it's been discussed for 3 months that we've had a structural deficit.
Most people don't pay attention, Andy, until you start cutting staff. When you start cutting teachers, that's when you're going to really have the rooms full and say, what the hell have you people been doing?
So two things that I think would be helpful for the board. By state law, if you have an operation question, it has to be separate from a bond question. In other words, the building question has to be unique. I think the board needs to act on that. We have a motion and a second there. Then it would be appropriate for the board to come back and say, we do or don't want to deal with operations tonight, and we do or don't want to use referendum, recurring or non-recurring, as an option. You know, we deferred about $350,000 worth of spending, things that we would have purchased in technology, security and safety, and capital maintenance, things that we would have done had we had the full budget. That would translate roughly to about, if my math is correct, about a nickel, so that 209 would go to 214. That would have solved that issue for us this year.
But it's not over 25 or 30 years. That's a lot shorter term, isn't it?
Well, correct. In the bond, so the bond is like out for 20 years, right?
Right.
The recurring referendum is permanent in that it gives the board the borrowing authority.
Oh, I see.
So what you would have is a $350,000 budget that would be levied every year specifically for technology, security, and capital projects. Mm. If you don't feel like you want to do any of those, you only levy nothing, or you levy half of it.
Gotcha.
But the board has to certify that levy every year to say, yes, we need all 350 of that, or no, we don't, because we are going to do these projects, and it's within the what we said we're going to use that money for. That's one way to get to it. The other way that I think Jeff is approaching is, if we don't raise additional revenue, it has to come through further reductions, whether it be through attrition, actual staff cuts. We, as you've seen our budget, we've gone through the process and we'll continue to go through tonight. There just simply is no other places to go. In fact, we've gone so far that you'll hear from Vicki tonight about how we went too far in some ways. So that's the reality of where we're at. And so I would suggest act on the bond, and then potentially have a discussion of whether you want to put an operational question on the referendum or not. And bring
would
back
this be what's mentioned here, number item number two, about
that is correct.
Limit for 350.
It could be any amount that you choose. Mm-hmm. And it just gives you the borrowing authority up to that level. You still have to certify that annually. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't automatically come in as a levy. It's whatever the board determines that they want to authorize as a levy to do certain things. And again, you'd have the month of July. Is a rough resolution. People can speak to it. August would be the final resolution, and then there would be education that would happen between the August date and the November referendum to fully inform and educate the community on what it is that's being proposed, and they ultimately vote it up or down.
Well, keep in mind that the maintenance budget has been ridiculous at $100,000 a year. Mm-hmm. So if you're going to go for operation, I really think you need to look at adding to that for our maintenance. That's just my opinion. So we have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion?
And the motion was for the $11,900,000?
$917,894.
So the full package?
The full package, correct.
That's what we're voting.
That was the motion and second.
Just to keep the plans going, as a rough draft, just to keep the plans going.
Right.
So,
I mean, it's not final till August, right? So we'll have a chance to toss it out there, get community feedback. You know,
so
if the community sees the price tag and gives us lots of negative feedback, that would be helpful in my mind.
I mean, that's the thing. What are we doing by keeping the ball rolling right now?
Well, keeping the ball rolling is keeping our doors open in the buildings we have.
Okay, so this would direct me to bring back a draft resolution for the board to further receive input and comment on. If it passes the July board meeting, it doesn't need further action, but if you get the comments and you don't decide to change the resolution, and that final resolution comes back in August for a final yes or no upper.
So the bonds don't go out to bid until the referendum is actually passed, as is, you can't really, you know, iron out the exact interest rate until that time. I got you.
Okay.
Yep.
Bush?
Yes.
Chambers?
Yes.
Dunn?
Yes.
Dunlap?
No.
Lindsay?
Yes.
Steffes?
No.
And Basti?
No.
4-3
carried. Okay, preliminary budget.
Before the board is a budget summary that now reflects a balanced budget. There was, if you remember, in just a quick history, we started with $326,000 of shortfall. That didn't include all of the wants, the needs, the desires. That was just rolling forward our current operational needs. And as we worked through the process of reducing and making reductions, we looked at all areas, and we got it down to 150 at one point, as we discussed with the board, and we continue to work through that process. Through our last board meeting, we got it down to $86,000 as a shortfall that needed to be balanced. Working again with our insurance representatives and Dean Insurance, we were able to look at a scenario that brings a higher deductible plan than what we currently have. That higher deductible allows us to reduce our premiums further. Those savings then translate into passing or putting forward in front of you a balanced budget. Out of pocket, it doesn't change the health reimbursement amount of $100-$200 that the teachers are currently paying, but it does increase the deductible that Dean sees that we're paying, and then we reimburse the difference down to the current deductible rates. So that was the strategy that was deployed to least impact employees in the budget at this late game. We couldn't further do anything with instructional materials, operational services. Staffing at this point is pretty much set. There is some things before the board tonight that you can act to or react to, but basically the opportunities were limited to find additional savings at this late in the game. So the preliminary budget is before you. If there are any additions or deletions, we'll make those as part of the final approval tonight. But this is the night where the board would take action to approve the preliminary budget. That allows us to move forward with the budget as proposed so that we can start to make purchases over the summer in preparation for schools opening in September. Vicki had asked for the opportunity to address the board because inside of this budget it creates some challenges for her that she'd like to just share. And if there's any other things that need to be included or removed from the budget, we would also entertain that.
Go ahead.
Yes, thank you. I'll follow up with you tomorrow, Christy. Thanks.
I had a question on your budget. You know, this it's on page 70, the new energy long-term debt service. I wasn't understanding. It shows it's a zero increase. But it was zero budgeted item before, and then I see suddenly now almost $118,000, and it still says zero increase. I don't quite follow that.
I'm going to have to get caught up with Mr.
It's page 70, and it's called titled New Energy Long-Term Debt Service. In the past it was zero, and now it's quite a bit, but it shows that it's a net zero increase. Makes no sense.
So the, okay, I see in the Fund 38.
Right, Fund 38 is, you know, it's a zero increase, but yet it was never there before.
Yeah, this is the roof project.
This is the what project?
This is the roof project.
Oh, the roof, yeah. Okay.
So this comes in new this year as part of that. The reason it's in Fund 38 is it was non-referendum approved.
Okay.
And we know that we have a note out there, and we have to make the $62,000 in annual payments for that roof project and related remodeling and repairs. So that's a new expense going forward.
Gotcha. Thanks.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Sure. Okay. I'd like the board to reconsider cutting our event workers. I've been at this a long time, And my experience with volunteers is you're going to get people who do not know how to run the clocks. They're not going to know how to keep book. And the last thing that we need at our official scores table for home events is problems.
What was the dollar amount in that?
Dollar amount was, let's see, was it 20, 30,000, Luke, I think was cut?
Yeah, I think that's in the ballpark. I don't have the exact number.
I coached volleyball for like 18 years. And scoring volleyball is still confusing to me.
Can you refresh us, Vicki? Did that come from Luke or did that come from the board?
I was just told that my workers were going to be cut.
Was that a recommendation for me?
It was part of our discussion when we talked about having to go to volunteer workers for table workers, timer scores, site control, crowd control, ticket takers.
Okay.
Yeah. So we did reduce the budget to try to get us within that balance piece.
And just walk in those doors and look to the right and look at all those sportsmanship plaques that we have. It's not just me, but it's also my workers who know what is expected. And our new football stadium, if I have to cut back on ticket takers, we're going to use both entrances, one ticket person at each entrance, and there's going to be traffic backed up to Water Tower Park.
Can I ask you a couple questions, Dick?
Mm-hmm.
How long have these event workers been paid?
I've been at this 29 years.
Do you remember?
Yeah, ever since I started.
Okay. The other question is, I mean, you get to know the event takers, the scorekeepers,
mm-hmm.
you know, the down linesmen, those guys.
Yeah.
I imagine some of them, you know, do it because they love to do it. I mean, can you just give me a rough estimate of, you know, let's say you yank payment for all of this, how many people you think would just say, hey, I'm quitting unless you pay me?
I have already had my experienced workers at my basketball scorers tables tell me they're not going to work.
As volunteers.
Mm-hmm. And really, it's a steal for us because they're working a JV and a varsity event. They get $20. If they're in another district, they're probably getting $40. We don't pay our workers much. It's $20. For two games. Now middle school workers, yeah, we have both courts going and they get $20, but our high school workers, you know, they're working a JV and a varsity event for $20. And then for me, I'm game manager, so I'm responsible for the teams, the officials, crowd control, tickets, finances. So sometimes I am not in the gym, so I need another person in there. And even, you know, sometimes it's, you know, ticket takers when I'm not in there that will be dealing with situations or answering questions.
What percentage of your funding would you say goes to like high-profile events or like high-risk events where you need experienced people, you need the place managed, you know, maybe high population attendance, you know, high-profile sports like football, basketball,
wrestling.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I mean, does that take a huge percentage of your budget, or do you pay everyone the same regardless of the profile?
It does. I have more workers for those events. I know I could cut back on my tickets. We'll keep everything locked and just have two ticket takers at the front entrance. There's going to be lines, and there's going to be long lines. People are going to be standing outside, but I can do it. And then they're going to come complain to me, and guess what I'm going to tell them?
Talk to the school board.
Talk to the school board, because this is not my decision.
Which would be true.
Right. And, you know, look at the success of our athletic programs. We get into a tight game or there's a tight match and the clock operator doesn't know what they're doing and they don't stop the clock or start it on time. Official book. You have to go by the official book. And if there's a mistake and our official score is wrong, it doesn't matter. because it's official. I lost a high school volleyball match because of that. Our official scorer made a mistake. Not I, my team did.
Is there somewhere else we can pull 20,000?
With the health savings insurance, there's also then a reduction in premium means a reduction to the alternative benefit plan, which is for those that receive a portion of the single for not taking insurance. And in short, that puts around $17,500 into what we built back in was that contingency fund. If something were to break, an equipment piece went down, like the refrigeration system did this year, we would then have some money in contingency. We could move that back out of contingency because the budget we presented last month was at zero. We had already removed that. We can go back to zero for contingency and fund personnel services. We already talked about being strategic about which contests would have EMS coverage or police coverage and which ones wouldn't. But that's really where we're getting to the point. And I know Vicky's point is around athletics, but Mitch could speak to the number of things that we've cut out that I would consider core essentials, workbooks for choir, workbooks for band. We're down to, Carrie is here, $250, I believe, is her classroom budget for the entire year for instructional materials. We're out of opportunities. We're at our last resort, which is, again, kind of a path that makes it challenging. We need to either live within our means and continue to reduce as costs become more expensive over time. Or the other alternative is to look at that operational discussion again. If I were to recommend something to the board, I would consider in a November election with an anticipated really high turnout of letting the voters tell us if they want us to live within our means or they support a $350,000 operational revenue referendum to put in some of the cuts that we've already made. We've already deferred a lot of our capital discussions. We know we have a rusted frame door right outside my door where they're literally starting to fall off the hinges, but we don't have a budget to replace that. So we want to take care of our buildings, but we need funds to do that. That's the capital part of it. There's other pieces that, as we continue to deflect and defray, we're just not going to be able to do the things that we've been traditionally able to do without a source of revenue.
I'll reassess everything, and I'll cut back where I can. We can't go without those experienced scorers and timers. Can't do it.
I've been in events where we're not experienced and it's bad.
I can cut back on ticket takers.
I understand, Vicki, but Carrie's argument holds so much more water with me than ticket takers.
Whose argument?
Instructional materials.
Oh, sure. That's fine. I'll give you a schedule, Larry, and you can tell me what game you want to work.
Yeah. Who's asking about volunteers? I think the list would be lengthy if you asked volunteers to work them. And I honestly thought they were volunteers. I didn't know everybody got paid.
Nope.
Why don't we just let everybody in for nothing and we wouldn't have to have ticket takers?
You still have
to. WIA will not allow you to do that for tournament games.
Yeah, we got a revenue issue then.
We have a who?
We got a revenue issue.
How do you think we make our
money?
Do
we keep that? Do we keep that money?
Yeah.
That's all.
Yes. So in my mind, that's one of the reasons why your workers should get paid. Is because we're taking in money at our athletic events.
And none of the tournament things come out of her budget. Those things, those workers are reimbursed through the WIA monies.
But that monies we don't keep, the admission.
We split 50-50 on volleyball, but everything else is, we keep 25 and they get 75 for everything else.
We do get some money.
So volleyball's 50-50 and the rest 25?
And 75. Don't ask me why they do that, but I love volleyball because we make good money on volleyball.
Is there boys volleyball?
There is. So it's the same.
Roughly between 18 and 24,000 could be saved.
Additional. Mm-hmm. So why are we not thinking about doing that?
We can open the discussion up. Do you want to bring up your idea?
I had emailed Luke earlier today, and I'm like, $100 to $200 deductible out of pocket for staff is ridiculous. And I don't know anybody else that is in that ballpark. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I don't think that asking $250 or $500
And Luke said we would save another $24,000.
Is that per occurrence or per year?
Per year.
That'd be annually. Currently, what staff...
Are we talking about health deductible? Is that what you're talking about, Jeff?
Yes.
Okay.
So currently, the staff pay 12% of their premium, and their deductibles through a health reimbursement account is 100 and 200. So we have a high deductible plan right now of, I think it's 3,000, 6,000. And if we increase that to the 4,000, I'm sorry, currently we're at 2,000, 4,000 is the high deductible premium that we're paying for utilizing Dean services. We reimburse through a health reimbursement account down to the 100, 200 deductible level. That's kind of a self-reimbursing scenario. Staff currently pay 12% of the insurance premium out of their paycheck. So 12% of their annual premiums is the current rate that staff are paying and have a 100, 200 deductible.
The 12% was out of our control. That's mandated by
state. You can control that. It's only if you're on the state insurance plan that you're mandated to do the 12%. So we could go to zero, we could go to 20. We have that flexibility. If you take the state's insurance plan, then it's mandated at 12%. But we're using a private insurance company, so we're not mandated to be at 12. Currently, next year, with this savings, basically, we've increased the premium to 4,000, 8,000 is the new high deductible premium. Where we have the budget savings is we have staff currently holding at their current contribution levels. But because the premium drops, that actually increases their percentage of contribution from 12% to 13%. 13% would be very high. 12% is pretty standard, but not many go above that because in traditional days of schools, they paid 0%. Mineral Point was paying 12% prior to my arrival 7 years ago, so they were ahead of making those contributions already. Now their percentage would be 13%, and on top of that, you'd be layering in an additional 150 or 300, I believe is the number, if you go to 250, 500, as Jeff is proposing. What that allows us to do is then we don't reimburse all the way back to 100, 200, we reimburse back to 150 and 500, I'm sorry, 250 and 500. I'm not sure our split of staff that take a single versus family, but on a 60-40 split, it would save $24,000. On a 70-30 split, it would save roughly about $18,000. I don't recommend it in that we have a balanced budget, and I don't need to necessarily ask staff to pay more out of pocket when we have a balanced budget. I think it's in excess. Already going forward, they'll pay 13% versus 12. But it is a...
And their raise was what?
The raise was 3% on average across all staff. Not all staff received
3%. Right, but then it's down to 2%.
But you got to remember we have a balanced budget because we literally have cut everything.
Everything. I agree.
That's the problem.
So it's a strategy that the board can consider to use that to fund athletics. We've got the surplus from the initial cost savings that could be used to offset some of Vicki's woes. There are a lot of competing interests and needs. To Larry's point, that if we had an extra $20,000, we might want to put everything back on the table and look at where that $20,000 might go first, second, third. Vicki's would certainly be at the top of my list. I support her request, but we're living within a finite amount of dollars.
Something closely related, Luke, is the alternative benefit plan. Can you explain to myself and maybe the new board members what that is and what that's costing us?
Yeah, I don't have the cost to the district for this meeting, but what I can tell you is the alternative benefit plan. When you hire somebody into the district, you typically offer them insurance and compensation. So their total compensation then is the two of those combined. In most cases, when I first arrived, everyone was taking insurance whether they needed it or not. And so we had family members that were paying, we were paying $14,000 for them to take a family insurance plan when my husband already had a family insurance plan. What that does is if you're in the secondary position, the primary picks up the bulk of the cost, and anything that's left over is picked up by the secondary insured. So we were paying $14,000 for somebody to kind of pick up those other things. What we offered was an alternative to those families that already had proof of insurance with other means. We would reimburse them the employer's share toward a single. Right now that is 87%, next year 88% this year. That roughly turns into about $5,500 or $5,600. We give that to them as a flat deduct, they can put it in a tax deductible or tax sheltered annuity plan and use that as somewhat of a retirement account. Then they no longer take the family insurance. So it's actually a savings from the district from somebody who was taking the $14,000 plan, receiving the single plan amount, and still receiving total compensation and benefit.
So if we have two staff members here, they don't qualify for this, correct?
We have roughly a quarter of our staff, 25, maybe as much as a third, up to 33, but not more than are currently taking the alternative benefit plan. A good solid 25 for sure.
If Nate and his wife both work here as teachers.
Sure.
That they don't qualify because they're in this district.
They do qualify. So one would take the plan, the other would
take the 14,000, and then the other one gets 5,500 on top.
Correct. In the old days, they were both eligible for both getting 14,000. And why wouldn't you take it if you're eligible for it, and it pays the secondary costs after the primary is completely exhausted? So there's no advantage for you not to take the family.
So what Jeff's questioning is, I think what you're questioning, Jeff, is if a couple works within the district, why wouldn't they just get a family, one single family plan? Is that what you're questioning?
And the other spouse would be ineligible for the alternative benefit.
Right.
Because we're not saving the family plan because you're in a different district. If we were two staff members and you're being covered from another district or some other job, I'm covered under your plan. So I can see that as a benefit, but if we're both in the same district, whether it's here or any other district, why should you get $5,500 just because I'm here?
What committee would look at that as far as changing HR policy?
Finance committee would be most likely the one that seems to come to mind. Well, keeping in mind Affordable Care Act laws mean that we have to offer insurance to every employee, whether they're married or not, whether they're in the district or not. And there is no advantage to not just taking the family plan and getting the biggest benefit you can get. If you had a catastrophic medical condition, a heart attack, and you had to be med-flighted into Madison, that would exhaust all of the primary insurance, and you'd have some secondary costs that would be natural. Those secondary costs would be picked up by a family plan. So anybody that's employed by the district wouldn't be well counseled to not take some type of form of insurance, because those additional costs would be picked up under the secondary insurer, which happens to be the same company.
That's two family plans under one family. That doesn't make sense.
Two employees where you have to offer insurance to each. You can't look at it
so,
as a joint plan.
So you couldn't say one gets a family plan, one gets a single. Is that a dumb question?
They get to elect which one of those two options.
And we can't determine what they elect.
Correct. Can't tell a family member they have to take a single.
So not only would this would be the same across, corporations would be the same way. If two people work there, they would both be offered, have to be legally offered insurance.
My assumption is that it works same in the private sector as the social sector, in that we're both under the same Affordable Care Act.
Okay.
Where employers have to offer insurance to each employee, regardless of marital status.
Is this commonplace, Luke, the whole alternative benefit plan program that we offer?
Yeah.
I mean, if you do the math on 33 employees at 50, you said about 5,800?
Mm-hmm. At the same time, it's actually saving us money. And so again, you got
of course, we would get some of them back, but would we get them all?
There are a fourth of our staff that would have qualified for the family plan that are taking the alternative benefit plan. And so they have calculated that risk, that they don't need the secondary insured, and they would rather take the tax sheltered annuity purchase or buyout. So instead of paying $14,000, we're paying $5,700. That's a win for the district. So the point is, you could eliminate the alternative benefit plan.
Say that again. Say this cost savings.
$14,000 versus I think it's $5,700.
$5,700.
The $14,000 is the entire amount. The district
right.
portion is 88% of that. So
right.
I need to get that actual.
Personally, I don't see how that could be legal. Either you're taking the insurance or you're not.
Yeah, it is. If you have
do that.
If you have proof of insurance, yeah. The alternative benefit plan is in other districts, and it was part of the WASB handbook as a recommended language that was, I don't want to say recommended, it was optional language that the district could or could not adopt if they so chose. So we've had it in place now for minimally 6 years. And again, it's been a good program for staff because a fourth of them are taking the opportunity to utilize that benefit rather than full family insurance from the district.
So we go to Jeff's point, raising the deductible to the 250 and 500. Would save us roughly 18 to 24.
18 to 24 on some quick math that I did late afternoon. If you took the $5,500 roughly for the district's contribution of a single, and multiply that roughly out by 25 staff, if I've got that number right, 5,500 times 25 is roughly $137,500.
I think you gotta be careful. I'm sorry, but what's gonna happen is you're gonna pit staff against each other, because then they're gonna be really ticked off about the people that are on the alternative benefit plan, because you're making the people that are not on the alternative benefit plan, you're gonna increase our deductibles.
Compared to the, if they all took the family insurance option, I took 88% of the 14,000 of the family plan and multiplied that by the 25 staff, that's 308,000. So if they all decided to jump in the alternative benefit plan, I'm just going to jump back on the family plan, 308,000 is what you pay.
Versus the
5,500 times 25 was 137,500.
137,500.
See, basically, I don't have a problem with the alternative.
Right. You're having a problem with the deductible.
No, I'm having a problem if on the alternative benefit plan, the whole idea, if we're a couple and you're working in Dodgeville and you're getting the family plan, then I have no problem, dues you and Nate, having given Nate that $5,500. But if you're both in Mineral Point, you're getting the family plan, so why should we have to pay him $5,500 just because you're both in the district? You're getting full family
I understand this discussion. I understand it, but I do not. I think this discussion should have been before how much people are getting paid. Because now what you're doing is that you've given them a baseline raise, whatever. Our teachers who make the school successful, the district successful, and now you're whittling away at their wages after you've given them a raise. I would be really upset.
Yeah, no, I'm not suggesting we do it this year. But I do think that it's something that should be looked at down the road, as Larry brought up.
If it's legal, but if it's not legal, then we can't do it. And I think you could probably get that answer really fast, Luke. Because then
changing the deductible,
yeah,
is legal. Change the deductible.
Yeah.
Well,
we're talking two different things
right
here.
No, I get it. My point though is that I would.
Oh, I agree with your point.
Because I mean. There's no negotiation on their part anyway. So what let's just, get a knife and start sticking it in after we, and
we've already done that, because this budget is, just to get that zero, we've cut everything. And it's like, what are we gonna do with the next five meetings when the next person after Vicki comes? Are we gonna keep bending on every $20,000? Because after five of them, that's $100,000.
Yep.
And I'm just saying, we're opening a can of worms.
Luke, is the budget as it was presented, does that include the $95,000 savings?
It does. The budget summary and the actual budget.
And there is one, and I apologize for not checking, that we had talked about before. There's an error, I think, on an employee. Okay. And I just can't ask an open session.
Let's talk about that, and it can be amended. Obviously, this is not the final budget. The final budget's approved in October, and the levy is certified at that time. So there are going to be changes, both on revenue and expenditures, both known and unknown. A grant comes in, a grant doesn't come in. We have an influx of open enrollment, or a bunch of kids fly out of here. There's a lot of things that are going to be able to be changed in the final budget. What this does is gives us a preliminary budget that we can start moving forward and making some
So you're looking for a motion to approve this preliminary budget?
I'd be looking for that, and that if that includes changes to athletics, then we would make those changes internally to put those dollars back in, if that's what you want. If you want to hold it the way it is, this is your last opportunity to give some direction.
It can be changed after, since it's just a budget and contracts are locked in for what they're locked in for. So it's just an error on the budget.
Yeah, you can change.
I mean, it can be amended, so it's not necessarily.
So, it doesn't make a motion
for whatever.
I'm sorry, Jeff, one more, just point of clarity. I mean, what I'm reading on the agenda is that there's two motions. One is to approve the change in the health insurance, and the other one's to approve the preliminary budget, right?
If you approve, yeah, they're linked. So if you approve the preliminary budget,
you're approving the health insurance changes.
Right.
Okay.
So then we would come back with that. You know, what happens if you approve the budget and not the health insurance changes, then we have to find $86,000 somewhere.
Okay. So would it be simplest to
you could
approve the health insurance change first or to approve the budget with the health insurance changes in it?
You could go in either order. I see your point.
See what I'm saying?
And the health insurance changes is from
a high deductible. Just to clarify,
that was a good question.
Yeah, yeah.
Goes to 2 and 4 to 4K.
So to be
going to the 250-500.
To be clear.
Yep,
just to be clear, the 4A deductible that we're moving to still falls under the HRA. So we're not, we're increasing our risk, does not affect the staff, but you have done
analysis of how many people reach with the
insurance company.
Yeah.
So let's make that clear that the risk is on
the district.
Okay.
Because the HR.
So we may not save 95,000.
That was my question.
Pardon?
If we don't, if we have a bad year, unfortunately, we don't want staff getting sick or so forth. But if they do, we're not going to save 95,000.
To that point,
we
have good water, and poor utilities. We have major malfunctions. You know, we're to your point. This is a year that we have to really hope that everything winds up.
Is that 95,000 based on last year's claims then?
So our claims rating does give us that 0% increase, and now what we've done is take that same claims rating and ask for additional benefit to be considered if we move to a higher deductible than what we're currently paying. So it's on the same.
But the actual claims from employees
are on the actual year to date from.
Okay, so that 95,000 is a reflection of last year's claim.
Correct.
Okay.
Year to date.
Vicki's request is that. Do we need that in here too?
If it's
a
I agree
with Vicki. It's like you can't have somebody like me trying to run one of those clocks.
How about ticket prices? Is there any flexibility on ticket prices? I had mentioned charging seniors $1, you know, because I mean, right now it's free. I mean, good Lord, I mean, there might I don't know what additional revenue that could possibly be.
We usually raise our ticket prices as a conference. We agree on a price and then all of us charge that same price.
Mm-hmm.
And we did go from
3 to 4.
3 to 4, which is similar to what you're going to pay for a regional game.
Mm-hmm.
And is everybody a senior so free?
Yeah.
Yes.
And what is it, 62, 65? 55.
Technically, I started getting AARP stuff,
yeah.
And I was like,
I've been there for 2 years. So.
But usually that we.
It's 62, isn't it?
Yeah, 62.
Okay.
Yeah.
I cannot support Vicki's request. I got a suggestion. Just go to the Booster Clubs, Vicki, and ask for some money for the ticket takers. If we want to put $20,000 back in the budget, Jeff, let's put it in there for instructional materials for kids. That would. They have no extra light bulbs for our smart boards. It's ridiculous.
Athletics for the kids, too.
I know, I understand. After the classroom.
The booster clubs are giving a lot of money to our sports programs because of the budget cuts. They're picking up a lot of the equipment.
Think our problem is that there's just no money.
I know, but I'm just saying we can't put all of this on the booster card.
No, I agree
am not going to go ask them for money for workers.
But I also agree with Larry. It's like,
you know,
I can take
tickets,
you
I can run the clock,
I
can keep the book.
I can't.
You know, I can do all that. I'll just run around. I can clone myself.
We need a motion.
What are the cons, again, to raise the 250 to 500? Like Jeff said, if that does put 18 to 24 in.
Yeah, it would be the out-of-pocket for a single or family member would increase by that difference.
Which, I mean,
$150.
We're not holding on that phone.
I know, I'm just, trying to see this, because that would maybe influence something if we are saving.
I would rather see you not give me the money for my workers than raise insurance. Do not do that to the staff. You will pit staff against each other with that alternative.
And we just, and as I said, that's something that should have been this before they got their raise.
Understand.
Because what you've done is you're starting, I mean, most raises are between 2.5 and 3.5. And most of those raises for the last 10 to 20 years have only covered health insurance for people. No one's ahead on the money game.
I would say it's been short.
It's food.
So, are you...
So, I'm looking for a motion.
I move we approve the preliminary budget as proposed.
Do we have a second?
I'll second.
Any more discussion?
This gets brought back to us how many more times?
One more time in October for a final approval.
Remember?
But savings that arise will be allocated where you want to allocate them between now and October.
Anything new on last year's budget, a surplus?
No. We're right now trying to cover all the budgets that have shortfalls. That reminds me that I was to load up into the agenda budget amendments that Marcia had given me for the board's consideration, but it's past our deadline to add that now. But we're trying to cover all of the shortfall accounts by rearranging those with budget amendments, so I'll have to put that on for approval in our next meeting.
I want to appreciate Vicki coming in now, because in October, as I said before, that's not the time for those teachers to come in. They need to come in before. We discussed how we were going to handle all this before. It didn't play out like that. So, you know, that October thing doesn't work.
Yeah.
All good discussion. Anything else, anybody?
Okay. The motion was to approve the preliminary budget as proposed. And the motion is second. Bush?
Yes.
Chambers?
Yes.
Dunn?
Yes.
Gunlock?
Yes.
Lindsay?
Yes.
Steffes?
No.
Basti?
Yes.
6-1. I just want to get clarity from the board as I bring back a draft resolution for a bond that you approved. This would be the time, if you're looking for longer term strategies to avoid some of the conversations we've had just recently and looking for additional revenue, is it your desire to bring back a referendum question around operations, and if so, would it be recurring, non-recurring, and if so, what would the amount be? And if not, we can move the agenda forward, but this would be the appropriate time in conjunction with the budget.
Do you
Unfortunately, imagine? Unless something changes with the state, which is blocking our funding, we're going to have to reach out to the local taxpayers, and I think it's appropriate to have a bond issue. I'm not sure about the amount, the $350,000, but I think it's appropriate to approach the public to see if they would support the local school through an additional bond referendum.
If the referendum passes and we don't get more money, we're going to have a hard time operating these schools.
Absolutely.
I'd be in favor of asking the public.
Well, I believe we should get some information out there then to let them know what they can expect.
Yeah.
Everyone's paying for it.
Yeah.
I also think they need to know the reasons, you know, how much less state aid we've got. How that's impacted the attempts to operate the schools at the current levels.
Can that be published in the paper? Because was the SPC ever published in the paper? Any of that information and diagrams or all that kind of stuff? It just didn't seem like it was as much as I thought it would be.
Well, the draft's all on the school website.
I know, but There are people who like still like that paper.
Yeah.
There, you know, a lot of people don't have that.
Yeah.
To answer your question, a draft resolution would be part of the board agenda, which would be published in July and again in August as a final authorization by the board. So it would be two consecutive months where that would be part of the agenda. The actual language, it has to be very technical, like you see there. The referendum question itself would look much like the resolution, but it would be, this is what the board is discussing, so that it's very transparent. And we have to do what's called a Class A notification within 10 days of the final resolution, which means that it needs to be more prominent yet. It can't just be buried in the agenda. It has to be a separate, standalone, large resolution that is very clear to the public that would pick up the paper. We'll still do our daily diligence to make sure we publish it using our local channels, whether it be social media, websites, and so forth. That'll obviously be a reflection of the meeting minutes. So your approval tonight of an operational referendum, I would suggest it be recurring, because our needs are not just 1 year. They're going to continue on. It again only authorizes your ability every year to determine what out of that amount you would use or not use and what for. And
do this in July, Luke?
You can do it in July, but again, the point being you need a rough resolution in July, and then the final in August is the recommended procedure. So I need some direction from the board if I'm putting something into the agenda, because if I don't have something from the board, we're just going to have a discussion item around recurring operational referendum, and doesn't really give the voter much information about what's being considered other than a discussion item. And you go right to a final from there without any opportunity for a draft resolution to be reviewed.
What do we pay for no rate analysis?
We get that currently with PMA.
Okay.
So that's part of the services.
I would at least like to see the impact of maybe a couple different numbers on the no rate.
Okay.
Around operations.
Yep.
For this potential resolution.
Oh, I see what you're asking for, different thresholds, that it's 100, 200, 300, 400, what the different mill rate would be.
I mean, or we could probably do the math. And
maybe like a 350 or a 500, is that what you're saying, or 500?
And I don't know what the, I don't know what the number is, but I think the number for this may surprise us on where it's
going.
The effect of what this recurring would do. And then we would have the knowledge of, okay, we're doing question one and question two, the mill rate after both would be this, and kind of, it may help us find a number of what, need.
What increments would you like so that I bother bond council once and not multiple times? It does take some time to turn that around. They do have the analysis done for the building bond, which you have here in front of you. So it would be adding a 350 to that second bond question. You could probably calculate it inside of this by just adding
350. If that's the number the board lands, and I would just like a mill rate analysis for whatever the
500 and a million, then you can do the math pretty easy from there.
Yeah, because what you're going to add basically to your $3,920,000, you've got the first bond at 8 and then the second at $3,920,000, you're probably going to add $350 to that $3,920,000. And then you've got the interest rate here at 4.25%. Again, I think that's pretty high. I think we could do better locally. But again, these are numbers not to exceed. We'd rather undersell and over-deliver than misrepresent a number in the community. So at a 4.25 interest rate, we can calculate what an additional $350 does to that pretty quickly for that first payment, and then translate out to mill rate. My quick math was about a nickel, but if we want to, I'll get that actual analysis at 350. We may want to consider if after that analysis the board can entertain whether they want to do a special meeting to bring back a draft resolution in conjunction with the bond, so you have two draft resolutions running concurrently rather than one out in front of the other. Because the question would be asked simultaneously, so I think you want to get those two to sync up. So we can run the analysis, and at some point in the future we can meet again prior to July, or we can go forward and get the analysis and then drop it off in July.
Meeting?
For a July meeting, correct. The other option, again, is it's a rough analysis, so you could authorize it today to bring back a draft resolution. The work would be done between now and July, and then you could decide at that time if you're going to go forward and drop the resolution before it becomes final.
That's my preference.
We can decide in July.
Bring it forward, and we'll decide in July when we have all the figures.
I think you okay with that, Ian?
Yeah, I just want to, I mean, I'm okay with bringing it forward for whatever the number is. I just like the number.
So then we would need a motion to bring a draft resolution for a recurring referendum of 350, if that's what we're hearing from the board.
Well,
between now and July, I would do the analysis.
Do we want 350? Do we want to do 500 in the meeting so we can?
I would do 500. Because 350 is only going to bring you back to zero.
Okay.
I mean, that's where we started.
And we're good with technology, safety and security, and capital maintenance.
And on top of it, you don't want to have to go back to the community in 2 years instead of hopefully 5 or 10.
That can also change in July. Andy, if you give us some conditional thought, you want it to be for something else specific?
Oh, I'm just asking. So you have direction.
Yeah.
If you bring it back with
it costs us nothing more to do with 350 and 5. That gives you a couple options. If 5 turns out to be, well, that's a little bit more than I thought, you've got a 350 fallback option, or you've got a...
I think that sounds good.
I think.
You think, Larry,
why would we do it?
Too?
5 and 1 million. 500,000 and 1 million. 350, like Jeff said, is going to bring us back to zero.
Yeah, I mean, we have nothing for maintenance, and we haven't for years.
Your motion.
Like 20.
I'll follow your lead.
I'm looking for a motion.
Okay, I move we ask for a draft resolution for a recurring referendum for $500,000 and $1 million, plus mill rate analysis for each proposal, and I'd like to see some sort of budget projections on how those would affect us going forward, meaning how long could we be in the black without running into another structural deficit?
Mm-hmm.
Would it be 2 years? Would it be 5 years? Would that be difficult to do without a consultant?
We can. We already have consulting services that we have retained for that purpose to help us run those analysis. I think we can do a fairly strong projection out 2 to 5 years. I don't know if I can project further than that. There is a wild card in the next biennial budget with another governor race. So, you know, we'll do the best we can with the information that we look at. Historical trends, and we can get dialed in pretty close to, on average, these increases have come forward in revenue and or expenditures, and I think we can get pretty close.
I'll second that.
I didn't remember the last $1 million. It took us 3-4 months to put that together, and here we're going to try to do this in 5 minutes. Is there something wrong with it?
We started in January, and we finished it up in April. So it was a December discussion.
I mean, how many public hearings on that?
We would have a similar number, but the timetable is roughly the same. We were running about from December to April was the last one, and now we're running from June right now into November.
But we just got handed this piece of paper with a proposal of a $350,000 recurring referendum. I know we need it. I'm trying to get the community on board here, because if they're not on board, we're going to have problems.
I think this is the exact thing to do for the community
right
now, because now it's public, right? There's a vote and a motion being published, so now the people know, hey, they're thinking about a recurring referendum. I better tell my board member what I think about that.
And let's clarify on the last vote we took on the school, 11.9, the 11.9, that could change to 7, that could change to 5.
Correct.
It could go to 15 million yet.
Correct.
Right.
So that's important to know.
Yeah, correct. I agree with that.
If you pass something like this, will this reduce state aid?
Actually, it increases state aid, because state aid is based on your expenditures. So as we increase our expenditures, we increase the amount of aid that we get for those expenditures that we make.
And it's all about, again, it's all about the mill rate to me. If we can keep that reasonable,
the chances for success are a lot higher.
So with this motion, we're asking for that information to come to an open meeting at the July meeting. Right, we'll have a draft resolution, we'll have mill rate analysis, we'll have budget projections. So now the community would have what we have to say, is this a good idea or not?
But we could have had that information already.
Oh, I see what you're saying. I think it's still a little rushed.
I mean, I can understand why you want to keep these two running side by side, and that does make sense to me. But the, if it...
I think if they weren't side by side, I think that some, that the taxpayers may think that we're trying to slide something around, or I like that everything's out front. We've had operations and maintenance issues for a long time that we haven't addressed, and I think we're making a bold statement this time that we as a board feel this is important, and our community needs to know that this is important, and it's been a long time coming. So yes, it's going to be really hard decisions, and we may have to be in your mind the time frame tighter, but I mean it's rough out there for every school district, so we're not having any issues that any other school district's not having by making hard decisions.
I read in the paper Barnville put $300,000 into their general fund. I don't know how they did it. I'm sure there's other reasons, but
ultimately the board is deciding to put a question in front of the community. The community decides yes or no. And
in my mind it's not a definite thing.
All we're doing right now is asking you to bring a question and figures back.
Information.
I'll be prepared.
Okay.
As another question. Bush.
Yes.
Chambers.
Yes.
Dunn.
Yes.
Gunlap.
Yes.
Lindsay.
Yes.
Steffes.
No.
Best.
Yes.
6-1.
Approval of post-library media specialist.
We do have the insurance that I think is handcuffed to the budget. To Aaron's point, it's more of a formality.
Actually, I'm going back to the health insurance. I think I need a motion to do the deductible increase.
I'll make a motion.
4-8.
Second.
Are we doing
yes.
the 4-8?
Yep.
Okay.
Yes.
Second.
Okay, thank you. Any further discussion?
No, I don't think so. Is that Kelly? Who's the second?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thanks. Bush?
Yes.
Chambers?
Yes.
Dunn?
Yes.
Gunlong?
Yes.
Lindsay?
Yes.
Steffes?
Yes.
And Bastien?
Yes.
7-0.
Okay.
Information for discussion? Do you have that?
Are we on 8, employee services?
Oh, I'm sorry. For discussion, I missed that one too.
Item 7, items
for information. Can you table this items for information? We have closed sessions to go into, and we've got employee services and business services. Can we table that?
Make a motion.
Can we do a really, just a real quick, brief up to date? And I know the Brewers are here for that.
To the board.
Where do we stand on that, Luke? What are you thinking? Why is it on the agenda?
The strategic plan information?
Right.
Part of it has what the community has brought forward as a strategic plan to connect the community and the board. Inside of that are some specific action plans that the board needs to take action on. One of those is to meet with the community in listening sessions that are outside of a regular board meeting. And there's other things that are inside of this as we look at those bullet points that the board may want to choose to set some board goals around and or set some action plans around. So this is an opportunity for you to look at that strategic plan and decide what it is that you might want to do to engage that focus area that clearly came forward as an area of importance for the strategic planning committee.
And I think the listening sessions should be put on some type of a schedule.
And we're getting this now?
No, this has been out there for a while now. We put it on the agenda before it was tabled to wait for the new board to be seated, and now at that May meeting was tabled again in order for us to have it was a long agenda, so I just keep this before the board.
Is everyone okay with this?
Yeah, I'm okay with it. Mm-hmm. So I guess the question is, do we want to sort this out in a regular board meeting as far as making a plan, scheduling listening sessions, you know, looking at the audits, reviewing the policy and rules? I mean, or do, is that a...
What does it come under the guise under?
Can that be done in committee? I'm sorry, what did you ask, Kelly?
What, under what committee?
That's what I was going to ask.
Okay, I had the same question. I asked first. Pardon? No, I'm sorry.
So what committee are you recommending?
Well,
why don't we have Lou just bring a plan to us with a schedule of listening, just start with the listening sessions.
Well, let me go further then. There's about five bullet points out of all of these that I think the board needs to really hone in on. The first one is developing a plan to listen back to the community by hosting regular listening sessions and brainstorming sessions beyond the routine business meeting. So the question is, how often, where do you meet, and we can then decide an agenda for guiding a discussion and or just listening to what other people's concerns are as they come over. So do you want to meet, I think the suggestion, as I recall, is at least twice a year, probably offside the school campus. Gives you a little bit less formal feeling, but maybe it's in the library at small round tables where people can come in and meet with board members and share their questions or concerns. It's a very timely time to have a discussion or a listening session, as we've just put two big resolutions potentially on the table. So this is a great opportunity for us to maybe think about between now and November, and again, maybe from November to next spring.
I think we will maintain a strategic and long-range plan developed with the transparent involvement of all stakeholders. I think some of this should be written into policy, so I don't think some of it's pertinent. We will video, we do that. We review the policy roles and responsibilities, and that some of this should be just within our policy, not just within the strategic plan. So I think that needs to be weeded out. We need to decide what's in policy and what's not. So maybe we understand that and come back with that next month.
So really, again, we're back to the listening, learning, and brainstorming sessions.
Yep.
I think the next one is the first one, third, fourth. It'd be the second one down on the next page. Developing a board action plan. 15 minutes to either, and this is kind of around the idea of professional development, to read an article, conduct a simulation, receive some professional development from WASB or a comparable service. So that would be something, again, that the board would want to have some input on.
Keep around.
There's a paper copy.
Oh, yeah.
I think if you started with those two, it would be a good place to start to develop just some basic action plans around how the board wants to function. There's other areas that we can spend time on later.
Yeah, you know, WASABI supplies their, what do you want to call it, perfect policy manual.
If I be on WASABI?
Yeah. And, I don't know what it costs. I didn't inquire, but they said that they were available to us to compare what we have for policy. And
we are a subscriber. We can get you into that subscription link area.
Oh, okay.
The policy services.
Yeah.
Yes.
Because I'm in the process of reading the policies.
That'll get you into the area of best practice for policies.
Right. Uh-huh. Yeah, I'd like to have access to that.
So those two.
Cost.
Those two.
Pardon?
Those two.
Yeah, I would start with those two. I think are the most pressing, in that it really takes the board to take ownership of those two specifically. Some of the others, for instance, scheduling the annual auditor, I can take care of that and make sure there's an auditor that gives a full analysis and review annually. But some of these things, I can't determine when and where the listening sessions are, because I can't make seven of you commit to a certain time and location.
And I think some of them are, it's going out of a boundary of what's expected of us. Because I think some people's strengths are in one area and some are strengths in another area. And do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we are open to.
I don't think you have to give all the highlights here. You don't have to.
I mean, we have to. I mean, we're open to a phone call away. So.
I mean, I think it's fine to propose a listening session, one in the summer, one in the winter. I mean, I don't know how much we want to get in the details now I'm happy to sit on a committee to come up with a date and location. And I agree that a summer meeting would be very timely. I think the question is whether to coordinate it with a referendum campaign, or should we try to hold it before the August meeting where resolutions are nailed down? You know, yeah. I'd defer to, you know, what you think would be the best time for that. But I think, you know, certainly putting out all the designs and all the, almost like another design workshop, and then maybe have some of the bigger budget issues kind of explained in clear terms.
Have a two-part listening session.
Yeah, let's say, hey, let's talk about the school remodel. Let's talk about our budget issues.
Good point. You know, I would think right before school starts, because, you know, you don't interfere with a lot of people that might be on vacation or other things, yeah, July, August. So.
You think after we decide on the resolutions?
Right.
As kind of step one?
Yeah.
Okay.
So
this is our thought, you know.
Right.
So
which two? We're voting on one or two?
I don't know if we're voting at all. I haven't heard a motion.
Okay.
I like the summer winter idea. I think it breaks it up nicely. Summer's timing. Either the month of, and that's what the board needs to address, but the month of July is before the final resolution to get input at that point, or once the resolution's been finalized, whatever that might be, then the board has the opportunity to, we're going to be conducting a lot of educational and informational meetings regardless, but this would give you an opportunity to have some listening sessions outside of a board meeting about those resolutions. But it would have, you know, you can't change the resolution at that point, then it's locked down in August. It's just getting feedback and or educating the public at large about what the resolution is and why it's needed. So I think both have merits. It just depends on where you want to enter, and there's nothing to say you can't meet twice, but I think so close together, I'm not sure that would be meaningful.
Yeah, I'm afraid if we don't have a plan in place, it could be just sort of a scattering of ideas and rolling on.
Good point.
I think we should finalize what we as a board think and then present that. It may be shot down, but, you know, at least, because I'm afraid you could have
for
a thousand.
Session.
I think you could have a thousand voices trying to come up with an idea.
Who would we have plan these listening sessions? Would this be president, vice president? Would this be,
I think it'd be the whole
finance
board.
Committee, the whole board? Okay. So we would,
I can schedule something late.
Put on the next agenda? Or?
Early September, put it on our next agenda in July to talk about what are the bullet points that we might want to ask, and or I think as much of this, again, the key part here is the listening session, and not really come with an agenda, but just listen and be able to inform and understand and take questions and get answers for people.
For that part, and then the referendum
piece.
Part, then we need a lot of information.
Well,
yeah. Yeah. So
would it be okay to use the school library here, and if there's that many people, spill over to the gym where we sit out front to
get the people
that might. No, really. If it
no, I know. I'm
day,
sorry.
I don't know.
Yeah, that would be a good location for us to suddenly sit down at some tables and
where?
I always think off campus is better. The Opera House would be great. I think more people might feel more comfortable, but I've thrown that out there before too.
Well, I think you have more parking here at the Opera House.
Trying to scare people.
What?
Trying to
scare
people. We need any more.
No motion. It's an information discussion. I've got some good working ideas to get something off the ground in August or September. We'll look at locations. And, you know, I think in a future agenda, we might want to talk about a board action plan and how we want to look at professional.
And I think the other ones are part of policy, or just,
yep.
There's too much.
Good. Okay, let's move on. Approval of the library specialist.
Before you is part of a discussion item with regards to the the library media technology specialist is somebody that has been Carrie Cabot in the past. Carrie recently took a position at the fifth grade at the elementary, but then took another position at her alma mater where her kids attend school in Iowa Grant. And so we internally moved Jenny Singer, who was the number two candidate for the fifth grade position, into the fifth grade, which leaves a vacancy now in the library. The library allows us the opportunity for the board to consider whether to go forward with a posting or not. I have provided for the board a job description for you to look forward or look at with regards to the qualifications, the job goal, and some of the performance responsibilities. It's much more than the traditional just desk circulation. It has actually become a teaching position where they're inside of every classroom teaching everything from technology and keyboarding to supporting teachers as an instructional coach.
Is this in the present budget that will allow for this expense?
It's currently built into the budget.
That's what I know.
So there'd be additional savings in the budget if this position were not forwarded for posting. Matt Renwick was not able to be here. He is out of the area tonight, but he did put together a short video that he wanted to share with regards to the position that would help just understand. There's a little.
There's a presentation for the library media specialist position. What does a library media specialist do? I think you'd be surprised. Our library specialists teach the students quite often every day, not just in interventions like you saw on the last slide, but also teaching students about genre and selecting their favorite books. She works hand in hand with the classroom teachers and provides many supports for her kids to develop a love for literacy. Our library specialists also support staff. She will often lead professional development in many areas of literacy and technology, and be there as a coach as well when teachers are looking for more support and integrating some of these skills and ideas in the classroom. Technology integration doesn't happen by accident. Our library specialist has a curriculum that is geared toward each grade level by month, and focuses on the basics to get kids access to all the tools, as well shows both students and teachers how to apply these skills to real-world projects and creations. Our library specialist also acts as a building leader, educating other leaders and members of the community in her programming and how it's impacting kids in many ways. This work is tied very directly with our new strategic plan, and this position is an integral part of our process going forward. The library specialist not only supports literacy efforts, but also is a literate person themselves. Our past librarian has been a reader and has made her reading life visible for everyone to see, kids and staff. And this modeling is essential if we expect our students to become lifelong readers and writers. Of course, our librarian also runs the library, selecting current texts for our students to check out. But even this position has changed. And for example, developing book reviews, video recordings, book trailers, things like that, that go beyond just the printed word in ways to communicate our love of reading and how well we comprehend it. Coming from a school that did not have a full-time librarian to one that does, I can see the stark difference and the importance of having a librarian full-time in every school. I think if you ask many literacy gurus, they'll say the same thing. This is an essential position for all the reasons I've already covered.
Any questions you have? Matt and I did review and look at different options for filling the library. We thought about transferring existing employees into that position. We talked about reducing the position overall. We talked about trying to disperse those duties onto somebody else that already has a full plate. And ultimately, what we decided and came to the conclusion is it really then steps backwards and away from our strategic plan and not towards it. There's a lot of things around just a focus area around digital literacy and technology that is a focus area in our strategic plan. And this person is the person that is instrumental in being not just a librarian, but a technology coach, an instructional coach for teachers, supporting them, and a literacy coach, helping kids read and supporting interventions. We think it'd be a big step backwards if we didn't fill that position, and that's our recommendation to the board to post.
Is that their only computer class is in the library with that teacher, or do they have another?
Carrie, help me out. I think that's the only time they see the computers, right? I mean,
it's
obviously
official.
It's the only time it's actually instructionally based on showing them computer apps and so forth. I mean, you use computers in the back of your classroom in small pods of 3 to 5.
It's maybe done in small groups.
But it's not really a holistic group lesson on how to implement or keyboard or typewriting or those kinds of things.
I don't think we need it for kindergarten. I think that hands-free off of anything technology-wise would be beneficial for kindergartners. And I argued this 20 years ago, and I'm still going to stay with my reasoning is sound. Kids come to school, everybody says, well, they come to school with that, but I think kindergarten is more social, more comfort level, more getting to know the school system, making friends, emotional learning. So I think kindergarten could be cut out, and that would cut out part of the position. Not the library part, but the technology part.
So what FTE would you propose?
I beg your pardon?
What FTE would you propose?
They would have to figure it out.
Our recommendation is a 1.0.
So who else was in-house would be available to do that if we switched out around some grades?
Everyone currently has a full-time position, so there's really nobody that's available to do that unless you're just doubling up two roles onto one FTE.
You did recommend before the kindergarten be two positions and not three. Is that something that could be reconsidered?
The board could reconsider it. We've seen in the past that small class sizes, especially in grades K and 1, pre-K, K and 1, are desired by the community. And so we have maintained the small class sizes in the first grade and haven't used that as an option to shuffle staff. We wouldn't recommend that.
But you did recommend cutting it prior because you were looking at 20 kids, which is what we have this year.
We brought forward for the staff the option for reduction. The staff denied that, so we moved forward with the smaller class size strategy going forward.
But when you recommended staff reduction, what would have you proposed if we would have agreed?
If money were no object, we would not have proposed a cut there.
That's not what I asked. I asked if you asked for a staff reduction, you and Matt came. We said no, but what was your thinking behind that, and how would have you implemented that?
You had 42 kids that were moving forward from kindergarten to first grade, and two classes of 21 would have been the solution that was before the board. And that wasn't approved, so we moved on.
It wasn't first grade, it was kindergarten.
I'm sorry, kindergarten. Pre-K to kindergarten, thank you.
And are we still at 42?
The last count, I don't believe there's been any significant changes. Maybe a kid up or down, but 42 would be a pretty accurate number.
Well, it's everybody's pleasure.
I move to approve the position as proposed.
Second.
I'll second.
If the board decides not to approve this, Luke, would you keep Ms. Singer in the library and
no.
Booth, teacher?
You would keep.
The fifth grade is a very large class. It could not be split between two teachers.
I'm saying move a kindergarten teacher up to fifth grade then.
We already moved Ms. Singer up to fifth grade, so we have three teachers there.
All right.
Ms. Heimsoff, Ms. Besch, and Ms. Singer. So that would stay set. The encore rotation, as we know it right now, that moves through classes, delivering computer instruction would cease. We just simply wouldn't have a person available to give that. To the extent that we would try to keep the library open, Ms. Hubbard can do some programming, but can only take one class at a time. So if instruction's happening, opportunity for circulation or usable space.
So if we went down to two teachers for kindergarten, that leaves us a pool of how many teachers to determine who could take that library literacy specialist?
If you're removing an FTE out of kindergarten, that would make an available position to be able to be reallocated somewhere else. And again, we would most likely, if that were the board directive, we would probably look at all of our staffing across all grade levels and look to see who would be the best person to shift into a role to support the library. It wouldn't necessarily be a kindergarten teacher that may be the most qualified or the unique ability to service the library and computers. So that might be a domino. You know, somebody from a different grade level might come into kindergarten to fill the vacant, or I'm sorry, the other way around. Kindergarten might fill a vacancy at another grade level because that person is better suited to fill the library. So it would be.
And what for the elementary school? What's the highest certification those teachers have?
Teachers. Well, it depends, but most often it's K-6 or K-8, depending on their licensure. But they're redoing the licensure certification levels to become more independent and more flexible. So you have a little more flexibility, even if you're K-6, to reach up to 7-8, or if you're 6-12.
Well, they're the state's allowing you to do that?
Yeah, it's part of the relicensing with the lifetime licenses. They're trying to align. Over the years, they've had different levels of certification that overlap, and so a sixth grade teacher couldn't teach fifth, those kinds of things.
Right. Well, that's what they were educated for, was up through six or up through,
right.
through three, or that's not even done anymore. But,
right.
So there would be flexibility within the staff that may be K through eight.
There is some.
So it may not be a domino effect. I'm being devil's advocate here to see how this may work.
Mm-hmm. Any other discussion?
So can we just have a motion with no second?
I don't know, Dr. Lindsay, second.
Oh, I thought we had a second because we were discussing
it. I missed it. I'm Angie and myself today. Angie on her Spanish trip, so I'm not
all right.
Thanks, Dr. Lindsay. Sorry about that.
Sorry.
I'm caught up now.
Okay. No more discussion. Let's call the question.
Bush.
Or do you have to discussion anybody? Did I call too quick?
Can we get C? Can, what are you thinking, Amy?
I guess I would like to know the plan.
With not hiring.
If we don't post this, is the position going away, or is...
Can we fill within?
Or is that an opportunity we have through the emotion?
Has there been a change in certification for being a library media specialist?
Yeah, you do have to have a certified person in the district with a library media specialist license and degree. Chris McCoy and Carrie Cabot currently have that. Right now, the person being reassigned would have to work underneath the auspices of Chris in order to be able to be considered qualified to work in that position. So you're putting somebody without the specialty degree for a library media specialist into that role to try to service students and support teachers.
So that's what we were doing with Jenny?
That's what we were going to do with Jenny?
Correct.
But have her work directly under Carrie, who was
correct.
In the building.
Still in the building. Right.
So, I think that may work. I mean, we're not here to make the easy decisions. I mean, if for 1 year we have to do this, I think everybody can come up to the plate and go that one step further to make this work for the budget, for everyone. It will also take attitude to make this work.
We just passed a preliminary budget that includes this position.
Right.
Correct?
Correct.
So there's not a deficit that we need to make up for currently by not passing this position?
Yes, I got to remember.
I get the hesitancy. I just wanted to clarify that
right.
it's in
but
the
current this,
but
this also could
out of that budget, too.
I gotcha.
Right, so... I mean, this could be a total package of anywhere between savings of 45 to 50.
Yeah.
So
to replace some of the cuts that were made.
Right, and for 1 year, that I think that could be made, and I'm saying that as a board member, business thinking, and teacher centered, and I think it all has to do with an attitude. In an I can do attitude for 1 year.
Well, if we're lucky enough to pass operational referendum.
So that's my point that I think Jeff just stumbled on would be that this is not something we have to do because we have balanced the budget fiscally. So we can weather this storm for one more year and take a look. At that time, we're going to know a couple more things. If an operational referendum doesn't have, that we hire this position with the opportunity and the understanding that it may be a non-renewal after a year pending an outcome of a recurring referendum.
And see, I think we're just backtracking. I think that you proposed a staff reduction. You were going to put Jenny in place under Carrie, and you don't want to put someone in place under Chris. I mean, it all seems to be a little bit doublespeak here, all because we figured it into the budget when we could save 45 to 50,000.
Except Jenny's a new body versus using someone who's currently committed a full FTE doing another job. That's really the only difference. I get your point, Kelly. But you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I mean, Jenny would be a whole new person, even though she's not qualified. She's working under someone with certification. This would be using someone.
That person would still be under somebody.
Correct.
Right. And who's it?
Correct, but it would be someone who's already committed to a full-time FTE job description and being asked to do above and beyond that. Right. So
we would go down to two to kindergarten.
Potentially.
Right. Yes.
I see what you're saying. Okay.
So it's not above and beyond, it's making that reduction and still having someone within our staff fill that role under Chris for a year. Is that clear? I'm just making it clear what I'm suggesting.
Luke, maybe I'm trying to pro and con the freeing up budget space for the number of things that were core items that we took out versus a third, and when this is something that was brought to us, suggested with, I can certainly assume Matt had a plan in place for the dominoes if that was approved. The dominoes have changed, obviously. Just pro and con me a little bit on what that free budget money would possibly build back in versus a third.
Yeah, you've heard me stay pretty consistent on this, but I think our biggest assets that we have in this district are our teachers. And we've hired for quality. We've had some amazing contributions. And this was the first year that the elementary school was recognized as a distinguished school. I think part of that is because we've made a commitment to small class sizes time and time again. We've also made a commitment to infusing a lot of technology and teaching kids how to use that technology appropriately and to use that as a lever to enhance the educational curriculum. And we're stepping back from a lot of the good work that we've set up along these last few years by buying back, to that point, things versus people. People can get by with less things, but we can't get by with less people in my mind. If we have a situation that warrants it, will always bring a recommendation to reduce staffing when it warrants this. But this is a person that's actually instructing in the classrooms every day, every period, every hour, rotating through and teaching kids how to use technology appropriately. I don't think you want to step back in a time that there's more and more technology being infused into kids. We want to make sure we're using it appropriately and enhance the education. And I think we can bring in another real quality candidate like a Carrie Cabot. They can do amazing things with our staff, support them, support literacy, support kids, helping them read, helping them intervene when they're not reading well. And I say step back.
She was a reading interventionist.
She also helped with that as well. Mm-hmm.
So to be clear, the goal would be to hire a licensed or certified, so not just
correct
another teacher because
correct.
Carrie's no longer in
Right.
As we did with Jenny, because she overcoming Carrie. So we would be getting the library literary specialist and not the third grade teacher that we're putting in the library.
Right.
Plus the learning of professionals down at the elementary building. As Matt pointed out, you know, an impact on the students, but also an impact on the adults that are in the building and some of the learning that they get to go through as well.
Thanks for the answers.
You ready to vote?
Ready to call a question.
Bush.
Yes.
Chambers.
No.
Dunn.
Yes.
Kunmak.
No.
Lindsay.
Yes.
Steffes.
No.
Bastin.
No.
3-5, or 3-4.
The reason I voted no is 41 kids in a kindergarten class. I don't think more than three teachers.
Do we just want to provide direction there?
Certainly we can, but from paying an awful lot of administrative costs down here, I think they can come up with a solution.
Why not? What if their solution is to not have a library and that doesn't fix your kids in the kindergarten?
I think the recommendation is to find a staff member within the certification that can work under Chris and take, relocate a kindergarten teacher into an appropriate, if it's done in effect, a kindergarten teacher needs to move and someone else needs to move into library.
It's, I'm not sure that would be a recommendation. So
right, that's why
to take okay. action.
Because if that's why we voted the way we voted, then you want the result to be why you voted that way.
We should probably have a new motion then, right?
You
want us to start making them decisions, Andy?
No, I'm saying.
I don't know what they're all certified in.
I don't, but you voted because
I think it goes back to administration at this point.
It goes back to administration, yes.
Absolutely.
Oh, I'm okay with that then, but I think the vote was based on kindergarten class size.
So let's move on to the
solution may not.
I still like the charge teacher.
To Tanny's point, we're most likely not moving a first grade or a kindergarten teacher out. I mean, that's been discussed. That's not our first priority. So we're moving on.
So what will you do?
We'll come up with a plan. I don't want to, be forthcoming until I have a chance to talk to Matt and I have a chance to work this through together. We'll probably have to reduce in some other areas that we'll look at everything. So it's not for sure that it wouldn't come out of kindergarten. But we look at our intervention specialists, we look at our instructional coaching team, we look at all of the other services that deliver for kids. We've seen tremendous growth in our reading and math lately. We may not be able to provide that at the extent of providing the core curriculum first. So it's gonna look different, and I'm not sure we can get the same results, but we'll do our best.
So high school English language arts teacher, would somebody like to make a motion for that?
A motion that we approve Jason Eastman.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
Can you tell us a little bit about Mr. Smith?
Maybe Mitch can.
Mr. Smith currently is teaching English language arts in the Lancaster School District. He's been there 7 years. His wife has taken an administrative position in Argyle, so they were looking to move this direction from Lancaster. He has a master's in English language arts. He currently at the Lancaster School District is teaching a transcripted class for Southwest Tech. None of the candidates that applied had the AP experience, but in order to teach a class through either the Oshkosh or the CAP program, one of the requirements is you have to have a master's degree in that field. So my hope is we might be able to do a few things, including saving the district money on some of the Platteville Lit course and things like that in the very near future with this professional. He was the number one choice of the interview committee, and expressed the fact that he's had his eyes on the Middle Point School District for quite some time, hoping for an opening.
How many applicants did we have?
Ended up with 7 total, which is 2 more than I had a year ago when we hired Ms. Roskovius. So they're not out there really, but it's getting harder to find candidates.
And Mitch, you said we never found a male English teacher.
He wasn't there that night.
I never said those words.
Who said that?
You just said, make sure you hire a male.
I said, wouldn't it be nice? No, I said, wouldn't it be nice if we had a male English teacher? And somebody said, oh, what?
We had a male student teacher with Ms. Roskovius this year, who accepted a position in Boston before the end of school year.
Thanks, Mitch. Thanks for that.
Here we have a motion and a second. Any other discussion?
Lancaster's a very good school district, too. So, second tier.
Yeah.
Compared to Middle Point.
Yeah.
We're getting the best. We're getting one of the best.
Stop it.
Yes. Bush was a yes.
Chamber. They took a chamber.
Huh?
They took a chamber.
Yes.
Don, yes.
Yes.
Gunnar?
Yes.
Lindsay?
Yes.
Staffis?
Yes.
Basti?
Yes.
7-0.
Okay, business services.
We have a letter of resignations that.
Can we do those together?
Yes, you can do those.
I make a motion that we accept the resignation of Carrie Cabot and the resignation of Julie Whitburn, and I wish them well.
I'd like to point out, too, that Julie Whitburn's salary is still in the budget. Can I look through it?
That is correct. We're looking for a replacement for Julie's position, so that salary will just carry over to a new person in place. And we'll adjust that in the final budget.
Mm-hmm. So motion.
Second.
Any discussion?
No, we do a voice.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carried. Thank you very much. Credit card statement activity and bills payable.
I had a question on that, on the card statement. Why would we be buying a treadmill?
Special education would be my guess.
It was on the very first page.
Warren Burris treadmill under Dixie Dempsey.
Yeah, $200 for a treadmill. I thought that was odd.
Well, a lot of times for some of our special ed students, which we do in the middle school, sometimes their IEPs require them to have some type of physical activity in the morning that kind of gets them going. Mm-hmm.
Can't have them just run around the block, huh?
Probably not in the winter time when it's, you know, yeah.
I just
but
thought it was
that would be my guess. So we have a treadmill and exercise bike down in the middle level.
And then I need some clarification. What is Fund 60?
Fund 60 is the activity fund.
Okay.
So
because I see a number of the senior class was Fund 60, and I was trying to understand what that meant.
Yeah, so that would be fundraising efforts from the class, and then they would use that to fund a class gift at the end of the year. They should decide how to part with any existing funds and fund 60 by year's end.
Well, see, that Amazon Marketplace, Fund 60, $2,258.98 on the second page. So is that money that they're spending that they've earned? Or
correct. Yeah,
gotcha.
All of the revenue comes in is in the form of fundraising, and then it expends out toward the class for class needs.
Okay.
Whether it be hosting a prom or a homecoming sometimes, different classes are responsible for that.
So does that go with a camera that was purchased, a $1,000 camera?
Does anybody know for sure?
That might have been for the yearbook?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Not a very cheap camera, it's $1,094.
Will last 20 years.
I hope so.
Yearbooks aren't cheap either.
And that might be other accessories that came along with the camera, not just the body of the camera, but the lens and some flashes and some other kinds of things that go with it as well.
Yeah, I see it was total like almost $1,600.
had a couple of questions. One was furniture in your office.
Yeah, I gifted my table to Chris McCoy in her classroom, so I no longer have a location for us to have a meeting space. So it includes three stools and a small meeting table or conference table. We'll go.
There were some stadium lights too that I noticed. Is
yeah,
that just getting circulated through our account, or what's that for the 14?
Yeah, we made the expenditure. The funding source is Fund 21, which is the fundraising account.
Okay.
So we can show that expense directly to the money that was raised, but it comes through as an expenditure made by the district. We purchased the lights, retained ownership, and so forth.
How do you reimburse for conferences for the teachers? Do they make a request, and is there a general budget for that, or how is that called?
There is a sometimes teachers will request a certain budget in order to attend a conference. It'll include registration, mileage, travel expenses. A lot of times the registration and related expenses come from a Title II budget, and what Title II is a state grant that is given out. The federal government disperses title funds. And Title I is for reading initiatives, Title II is for professional development in schools, III is for English language arts, English language learners, and IV is a community family engagement fund. II specifically, then, the federal government gifts to the states disperse it based on how many pupils you have available in your school. And a lot of the expenditures are basically grant funded through that opportunity.
Where would that show up then in the general budget? Like when you get some funds like that, how do you put that into it when you don't know what you're getting? Is
yeah.
that sort of whatever comes in goes into a category?
It is loose until we get the final numbers from the federal government on title. Another one that's like that you hear us talk about is the Common School Fund. That's the state's disbursement of funds that are from building loans that they give out across the state, the interest. That they make on those loans then funds schools across not just schools but also libraries in municipalities as well. So there's a statewide clearinghouse for that as well. So they give low interest rate schools to municipal buildings and then use those funds to then disperse for the good of the use of students. However, to your point, a lot of times those final budgets don't come in until the revenue is known, which is very late, which is not in the preliminary budget, but would be part of our final budget. So we'll learn those numbers sometime late summer.
Do you give that a category like miscellaneous? Or you know?
There would be an actual line item that I could point you to that would, you'll see it under Chris McCoy's actual expenditure area. She has, it's hard to delineate. I can show you the accounting code, but there's actual numbers that would go for common school versus regular operational budget that we levy.
And we have codes for that they have to go on.
Correct.
Yeah.
And that money has to stay in the library.
Right.
Oh, that money can't be shifted to someone.
Can't use it for staffing or other needs. It's got to stay in the library.
What are all the stipend checks for? $500.
Summer literacy work, reading and doing writing assessments, coming in doing curriculum work over the summer. In our employee handbook, if you go beyond your contractual 190 days and are doing curriculum work, you'll receive a stipend for that.
And where are we sitting on the revenue side of food service that always used to run $300,000 and now they're $365,000?
I don't have the answer to the revenue. Today, Nancy Smith was in and she was doing inventory. Because inventory is the final component to determine what your assets are versus your liabilities. Once she has that done, then we can figure out what our total revenue and liabilities are and find out what our net is. So this is the upcoming year is a renewal year. So we do put out food service for bid in the 18-19 school year. So we'll go through that process of selecting a vendor. We're looking at other options for food service. And it's also a year that we will receive a Department of Public Instruction audit on our food service program.
Why are they, this is April, and why is it that they don't have May on here already?
I think they're always a month in the arrears, if I'm not mistaken.
makes it kind of difficult to make decisions, and if you are contemplating changing, it makes it pretty difficult when you're not going to know your for the bottom line that until July, when you had only a month to do whatever.
We will get our final numbers for 17-18, and then we'll use those to help us determine what we're going to do for 18-19, because that will be a process that we will start earlier in the year, November, December, January. We'll start that process of requesting for proposals from food service companies. So we won't have year-to-date next year, but we will have this year's final budget in before we make a decision for next year.
I've got to reiterate Nate's comment on the office furniture, $3,600. It seems a little extreme for three stools and a small table.
When they generally have that income statement finalized, the last year they presented it to us for food service.
I can ask for that report for a July meeting.
July or August.
Yeah.
Just curious where we ended it.
The sound system, is that kind of being reimbursed as well there?
It is, yes.
Okay.
Okay,
does
anybody want to make a motion?
So next time we had, so let Kristen Mitchell Designs was $4,200 or just about $4,300, and that was for the CPS, Zero Business for Survey, Newsletter, Postage, and Printing.
So that was your community survey and the newsletter. Two separate emails.
I'll help you with the newsletter too. What does that typically run?
God, I think it's like 2,000. 2,500 maybe?
It's usually over 3. Oh, like 3,200. It's been running.
So like a survey would be.
Yeah, I'm not sure. No. But the bulk of that is postage, also the time for anything you mail.
Mm-hmm. I have a question on that. So we have to pay the postage on that, even as a school. Like,
yes.
We're not nonprofit or
no,
anything like that.
We get a slight discount. I think it's like you pay 47 cents for a letter versus 50 or whatever it is now.
And I should know that, but I'm sorry.
Yeah.
And of course, that wasn't FDH's contract.
And it's more postage to mail the new letter to you, obviously.
So this was above and beyond what we paid FDH.
That's right. Because we already, Kristen already had the mailing house for all of our addresses and everything, so we didn't have to go through that a second time with the new company.
Used to make a motion, Jeff.
Yes, please.
Make a motion to approve.
Also.
Any other discussion?
Could we send that table and chairs back in your office?
They are already facetious at all.
Didn't mean to laugh, because good question.
So who's the second?
Dr. Lindsay. You gotta speak up, Don.
I will.
That's gonna be our next complaint. You're Dr. Lindsay.
Yes. So, far away. Before we go into closed session.
Wait a minute, we're not done with
this. Oh, let's get this done. Come on.
Push.
You got a question or something?
Yeah. I'd ask we could send that $3,600 expense back. What do we pay freight? How much was the freight on that? Do you remember?
I don't remember the freight on it.
Yes.
Chambers.
Yes.
Dunn.
Yes.
Gunlock.
Yes.
Lindsay.
Yes.
Steffens.
Yes.
Fasten.
So before we go into closed session, we've had a lot of discussion tonight, and there were a lot of yeses and noes, and this is not a personal attack, but I gave my attention that Aaron has his own webpage, and he's saying how he voted and why he voted, and that's a singular voice. and we are a collective voice. So if we are going to give reasons why we voted yes or voted no, that should be done by our PR person. And then we all have the same opportunity to say why we voted yes or voted no, and it's not a singular voice. And I think that would be best for our board to show that we're working together and we're not separating ourselves. Because that's the goal of this board, is to show them that we're collective and that we try really hard to make good decisions.
I would recommend before we go into discussion to put that on a future agenda, because it would be inappropriate to have a discussion around something that's not on the agenda or related to something on the agenda. And so I think it's a good conversation to have. I just think we want to duly note it and have the opportunity for anybody else that might want to be part of that discussion to be able to be present.
You okay with that, Aaron?
Yeah.
Being brought up?
Sure.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. I'm going to make a motion to go into closed session.
I'll make a motion. I'll second
it. Commission, Jeff Hawes in favor.
Aye.